So my wife has been field testing some of our microscopes by washing my clothes whenever I forget them in the dryer. So it turns out they're waterproof, and right here is just fluorescein water. And I don't know if you can actually see this. This also shows you how the projection scope works. You get to see the beam the way it's projected and bent. Can we get the lights back on again? So I'm quickly going to show you, since I'm running out of time, in terms of how much it costs for us to manufacture, the biggest idea was roll-to-roll manufacturing. So we built this out of 50 cents of parts and cost.
Do you think the world is going to be a better place next year, in the next decade? Can we end hunger, achieve gender equality, halt climate change, all in the next 15 years? Well, according to the governments of the world, yes, we can. In the last few days, the leaders of the world, meeting at the UN in New York, agreed a new set of global goals for the development of the world to 2030. And here they are. These goals are the product of a massive consultation exercise. The global goals are who we, humanity, want to be. Now that's the plan, but can we get there? Can this vision for a better world really be achieved? Well, I'm here today because we've run the numbers, and the answer, shockingly, is that maybe we actually can, but not with business as usual. Now, the idea that the world is going to get a better place may seem a little fanciful. Watch the news every day and the world seems to be going backwards, not forwards. And let's be frank, it's pretty easy to be skeptical about grand announcements coming out of the UN. But please, I invite you to suspend your disbelief for just a moment. Because back in 2001, the UN agreed another set of goals, the Millennium Development Goals. And the flagship target there was to halve the proportion of people living in poverty by 2015. The target was to take from a baseline of 1990, when 36% of the world's population lived in poverty, to get to 18% poverty this year. Did we hit this target? Well, no, we didn't. We exceeded it. This year, global poverty is going to fall to 12%. Now, that's still not good enough, and the world does still have plenty of problems. But the pessimists and doomsayers who say that the world can't get better are simply wrong. So how did we achieve the success? Well, a lot of it was because of economic growth. Some of the biggest reductions in poverty were in countries such as China and India, which have seen rapid economic growth in recent years. So can we pull off the same trick again? Can economic growth get us to the global goals? Well, to answer that question, we need to benchmark where the world is today against the global goals and figure out how far we have to travel. But that ain't easy, because the global goals aren't just ambitious, they're also pretty complicated. Of the 17 goals, there are then 169 targets and literally hundreds of indicators. Also, while some of the goals are pretty specific, end hunger, others are a lot vaguer, promote peaceful and tolerant societies. So to help us with this benchmarking, I'm going to use a tool called the Social Progress Index. What this does is measures all the stuff the global goals are trying to achieve, but sums it up into a single number that we can use as our benchmark and track progress over time. The Social Progress Index basically asks three fundamental questions about a society. First of all, does everyone have the basic needs of survival? Food, water, shelter, safety. Secondly, does everyone have the building blocks of a better life? Education, information, health, and a sustainable environment? And does everyone have the opportunity to improve their lives through rights, freedom of choice, freedom from discrimination, and access to the world's most advanced knowledge. The Social Progress Index sums all this together using 52 indicators to create an aggregate score on a scale of 0 to 100. And what we find is that there's a wide diversity of performance in the world today. The highest performing country, Norway, scores 88. The lowest performing country, Central African Republic, scores 31. And we can add up all the countries together, weighting for the different population sizes, and that global score is 61. In concrete terms, that means that the average human being is living at a level of social progress about the same of Cuba or Kazakhstan today. So that's where we are today, 61 out of 100. What do we have to get to achieve the global goals? Now, the global goals are certainly ambitious, but they're not about turning the world into Norway in just 15 years. So having looked at the numbers, my estimate is that a score of 75 would not only be a giant leap forward in human well-being, it would also count as hitting the global goals target. So there's our target, 75 out of 100. Can we get there? Well, the Social Progress Index can help us calculate this, because as you might have noticed, there are no economic indicators in there. There's no GDP or economic growth in the Social Progress Index model. And what that lets us do is understand the relationship between economic growth and social progress. Let me show you on this chart. So here on the vertical axis, I've put social progress, the stuff the global goals are trying to achieve. Higher is better. And then on the horizontal axis is GDP per capita. Further to the right means richer. And in there, I'm now going to put all the countries of the world, each one represented by a dot. And on top of that, I'm going to put the regression line that shows the average relationship. And what this tells us is that as we get richer, social progress does tend to improve. However, as we get richer, each extra dollar of GDP is buying us less and less social progress. And now we can use this information to start building our forecast. So, here is the world in 2015. We have a social progress score of 61 and a GDP per capita of $14,000. And the place we're trying to get to, remember, is 75 as our global goals target. So here we are today, $14,000 per capita GDP. How rich are we going to be in 2030? That's what we need to know next. Well, the best forecast we can find comes from the US Department of Agriculture, which forecasts 3.1% average global economic growth over the next 15 years, which means that in 2030, if they're right, per capita GDP will be about $23,000. So now the question is, if we get that much richer, how much social progress are we going to get? Well, we asked a team of economists at Deloitte who checked and crunched the numbers, and they came back and they said, well, look, if the world's wealth, per average wealth, goes from $14,000 a year to $23,000 a year, social progress is going to increase from 61 to 62.4. Just 62.4. Just a tiny increase. Now, this seems a bit strange. Economic growth seems to have really helped in the fight against poverty, but it doesn't seem to be having much impact on trying to get to the global goals. So what's going on? Well, I think there are two things. The first is that, in a way, we're the victims of our own success. We've used up the easy wins from economic growth, and now we're moving on to harder problems. And also, we know that economic growth comes with costs as well as benefits. There are costs to the environment, costs from new health problems like obesity.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Global Health Night. My name is Daniel Heldén.
My name is Emily Luft.
And we're going to lead you through this night.
Global Health Night is a collaboration between the Karolinska Institutet Center for Global Health, Institute for Indian Mother and Child, Swedish Organization for Global Health, and International Federation for Medical Students Association. This event all started as a student initiative with the aim to highlight global health and put it on the agenda.
And we're really happy to see that we're not alone in having this interest. We have an almost full house here tonight. Hope it's getting full soon. And we have students from all the different kind of disciplines. We have over 20 global health related organizations present, and we have a whole row of KAI representatives here.
Before we go ahead with the event, we have some safety instructions for you. In the unlikely event of an evacuation, you will hear a talking voice alarm. Please make your way through the nearest escape route. And we would also like to add that food and drinks are not allowed in the aula.
So, what's going to happen tonight? Well, it's really, really simple. Right after we've stopped talking, a lot more interesting people will start to talk. Somewhere in between all of those talks, we will have a short break where you will be able to go to the restroom or stretch your legs. After that, a couple of more people will have some interesting talks, and then the event or the lectures will be finished around 8.
And then it's your turn to talk. On the entrance floor and on the third floor, there will be a mingle where you can ask all your questions more informally to the speakers, meet the organizations, and also network with the participants. Don't worry, we'll have refreshments. During the mingle, we will have focus groups, and those of you who have been selected for these focus groups, please go directly to the location that was presented in your confirmation mail. If you have any questions on where to go, just ask our polite guides, know-it-alls, all around here. You can find the schedule for the event on the websites and on the Facebook page. Also, if you would like to use social media, please use our hashtag.
Now, we have talked way too long, and it's time to get started. The opening speaker is the director of the Center for Global Health here at Karolinska. He is a professor in epidemiology and has vast and long experience with the field of global health. He's a strong supporter of this event, and without him, this would not be possible. So please help us to give a warm welcome to Professor Vinod, Diwan.
Thank you very much, and very welcome from Karolinska Institute Center for Global Health. Center for Global Health has worked at Karolinska Institute to bring attention to the diseases of poor and in the context of poverty. In the world, poverty is the one important factor which influences health and the relationship between the poor and disease is in a vicious circle. So Karolinska, as a medical university, what can it do to improve health? It can do many things improving health, but by improving health, we will also decrease the poverty, because those who are poor, they are sick, and those who are sick, they are poor. And with this aim, Karolinska Institute Center for Global Health has a collaboration within Karolinska Institute with molecular medicine, with technical research, with public health, and clinical medicine. In all these areas, we try to find how can we improve the health of the poor in the context of poverty. From 1980s onward, poverty has decreased. As you have seen, that infant mortality, maternal mortality, and life expectancy has improved considerably. In 1940s, maybe 40% people lived below poverty line. Today, about 10 to 15% people in the world live below poverty. However, still 2 billion people are poor or destitute, and the vicious circle between poverty and disease has not stopped. That is why we at Karolinska Institute and Karolinska Institute Center for Global Health work to find ways to improve the health of the people anywhere in the world, as Karolinska Institute aims to improve health of the human being. It doesn't matter if they live in Sweden or elsewhere. So thank you for a large audience here who has come today to listen to many of the presentations. You will hear from important people from Karolinska Institute and elsewhere. However, what can you do to improve health of the people and decrease poverty? Medical students and others who are working nationally or internationally, they can work in as practice in many of the countries. They can work in the international organizations, but they can also work at the labs, at the departments, and at our research centers to improve the research, to find, to discover what can be used for improving the health of the poor people. Because without improving health, we will not be able to decrease the poverty. So with these few words, I would like to welcome you again and welcome to this seminar and workshop later on, and would like to invite you to many of the institutions within Karolinska Institute which are working with diseases of the poor and the in the context of poverty. Very welcome, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Vinod, for that very interesting speech, making us even more thrilled about this night.
So, now we move on to our first keynote speaker. She is a medical doctor and is currently co-chairing the elective course Global Health here at Karolinska Institute. Her research focus has in recent years changed towards global health, including Ebola clinical management and epidemiology, as well as non-communicable diseases. She has worked for Doctors Without Borders in Congo, and more lately, with the Ebola in Guinea and Liberia.
Please welcome Helena Nordenstedt. First of all, thank you very much for those who invited me here. Actually, I was invited to tell my story into global health because I gave a speech similar to this with, I think it was about 30 young female medical students, and it got really close and personal, and they said, maybe you can do it again. And here I am again, and it's not 30 medical students, it's you're a little bit more people around. But anyway, I'm honored to be here to speak in the presence of all those other distinguished speakers with a lot more experience in global health than I have. And I figure that that's probably why I'm the first speaker, because I am also the beginner in this context. So let me take you 4 years back. I will tell you a little bit about how I ended up in this discipline of global health. 4 years ago, I had a completely different career going on. I was finished with medical school. I was doing my residency clinically as a physician in gastroenterology at Karolinska here. I had finished my PhD, and I already done a postdoc in Texas. I came back, and now I was on my way to become a docent in clinical gastroenterology with more than 20 publications.
and everything was going very well. I was lecturing to biomedical medical students about acid disorders and heartburn, which happens to be my special subject, halsbränna for those of you who don't know. And I even was elected to become the president of the Young Swedish Gastroenterologists Association. And still something was missing. It was just something nudging all the time, like, I should be doing something else. I could do something more. I should be doing something more. Actually, please show me the first picture. Let's see. That's my thesis, if you don't believe me. So I do have a PhD in epidemiology of, and actually a PhD in surgery, and the subject is gastroesophageal reflux disease, basically heartburn. Anyway, let's see. And where do I change the for the next one? Right. So that was 4 years ago. I had no idea about global health, the academic discipline of global health. And I just knew that I wanted to see the world, do something more, try to be of more use, and maybe even contribute a little bit. And there is a backstory to this, because in my mind, I was thinking of the world, mostly Africa. And the reason why I was thinking about this is because I had been to Africa once, 10 years before as a medical student. And I was in the second year, I had an older classmate who had been to this elective course in global health. And she'd been to Tanzania, and she told me about this course, and she said, it's fantastic. I learned so much, and I got to go to Tanzania, and we had this really good professor, Professor Rosling, and he was so inspiring, and I really would like to go back to Tanzania to do my research project next summer. Would you like to come with me? And I was on in my third semester, and someone asked me going to Tanzania. Sure, why not? So we ended up in Tanzania. Oh, sorry, now I'm jumping ahead. So what we did is, how do you go to Tanzania if you want a project? You're a medical student. Well, what you do is, of course, you call that inspiring professor. So that my friend Katarina had met. So we called him and we asked, hello, Professor Rosling. We're two medical students and we would like to go to Tanzania in 10 months to do a research project. Can you help us? And he said, no, I don't have time for that. And then we're like, okay, thank you very much. And then he said, well, you said in 10 months? That's a very long time. Okay, I can help you. So, okay, sounds good. And he did. He did help us. So we ended up in Tanzania. And we spent a summer in Tanzania in 30 different villages in rural southern Tanzania exploring rectal use of artisanate and exploring views of people on in how, when, if they already knew about rectal administration of drugs. You can just imagine that topic. But sitting under the mango tree in a village in the middle of rural Tanzania, asking about their practices of using rectal drugs. Anyhow, that was a memory for life. And it was something I couldn't really forget. So even though I went back to medical school, I started my PhD studies, and I really got entrapped in this heartburn epidemiology. I just could not forget about Tanzania. So 4 years ago, when I was in the middle of my career, I was gonna become a docent in clinical gastroenterology. And what did I do? I sent an application letter to Doctors Without Borders. And I was admitted. They took me after several interviews. And I got the chance to go to Democratic Republic of Congo for 7 months to work. And I had a very good job. I really liked my job at Karolinska. I had great colleagues. The job was fine, but it was just not for me. But they were nice, my colleagues. They gave me the absence of leave, my boss, and I left. I came to Congo, and I was so nervous. I was nervous because I hadn't spoken French for 15 years, and I was nervous because I had never seen a child with malaria, and I was nervous because how would I fit into a context where, an insecure context, a conflict context. and I was very sure that I would not be adequate enough for this. But I wanted to try and see if maybe this was something for me. And then, why did I apply then, in 2011? I could maybe applied earlier, I could have waited, when I was really in the middle of getting somewhere in my career. I think Hans Rosling will talk more about this later, but when you do changes like this in your life, when you choose a new career, and especially when you choose to leave Sweden, your friends and your family, some things need to be in order. You have to have maybe not that many things stopping you, and I didn't. I had already been working in Norway, in Sweden. I had been working in Norway to get some money to buy an apartment, as many others maybe will do. And I had no relationship. I had my friends and family were healthy, and I was free to go. I was 32 years old. So it was easy for me to leave in that sense. Before, I was always occupied by a PhD or the postdoc or by supervising some students or by trying to get a place to live. But I was settled. It was easy to leave. And since, I've been working in Congo, in Liberia, and in Guinea. I just heard, actually, that Hans will not be showing this presentation tonight. There will be no bubbles tonight except this one. So, just so you know. Anyhow, in Congo, what happened is I got to... It was just as difficult as I thought. My French was just as bad as I thought, but it got better. And I knew just as little as I thought about children with malaria. If you have 50 children with malaria and per day, on the other hand, you learn quite fast. So quite fast, I did learn how to take care of children with malaria. I had some moments when I was really a stupid foreigner from a high-income country. I remember once I had a girl with an open fracture on her leg, a six-year-old, and we took her to the nearest hospital 4 hours away, where she could have an x-ray, an operation, and surgery, and a cast on her leg. And everything was fine. I came back 2 weeks later to check on her, and she was fine, and she kind of seemed a little bit bored, and her mom was there to take care of her. And she was supposed to stay there for 6 weeks. So I thought, maybe if I take her back home to her village, and she can stay there for 4 weeks, and I take her back for the control, and they take off the cast and the check x-ray after 4 more weeks, then that should be fine. I took them back, the mother and the child, to their village. And then when it was time to go back to take off the cast and do the extra x-ray and see if she needed any more surgery, the child never showed up. And I asked to go to her village again. I went there. I met the mother. And she said, well, when we came back, our neighbors asked us, why is she having a cast? Take it off. We have very good doctors here in our village, traditional healers. They will help her instead. So they took off the cast, and the girl started running on her leg. And fortunately, nothing happened. But it seemed to be okay. She was still limping, but she was walking on her leg. I have no idea what it looks like inside, but she was walking. And when I talked to my local colleagues, they were like, why did you take her back to her village? You should just have left her in the hospital. Of course she was not bored. It was fantastic for them to be in this big city where there was a hospital. She was not bored at all, and there they would not have taken away the cast. And I was in my mind very much thinking, I need to take them back home. Patients always want to be home, because that's what we do. It's a story from being a stupid foreigner in a context that you don't completely understand. So there are difficult situations. There were many children that I lost. It was horrible the first times, and you don't get used to it, but you learn to live with it every time. And then there were the other moments, like this is a picture from inside the ward in Congo. When this is the pediatric ward. And every time I would enter the pediatric ward, all the patients, So there's one or two children per bed, and they have one each patient has a parent there. And every time I would enter, the room would go quiet because they would say, oh, we get to have the foreign doctor today. Interesting, let's see what she will do today. And after some time, I got to know some local phrases in Kibembe. And for some reason, the rumor spread. Ah, that's the foreign doctor who knows Kibembe. And they knew exactly what phrases I knew in Kibembe, which happened to be like five, but they thought I spoke Kibembe. And so when I would come in the morning into the pediatric ward, and everyone would go quiet, and then someone would try me with one of those phrases that they knew I knew. It was like a game. And they would say, ah, doctor, Alamuana. It's like, hey, you're a good-looking one, which this means. And I say, yeah, you too, and your neighbors too, Nabachirani, I would answer. And then the whole world would just explode in laughter. And this was a game that we would just do day after day, and it was just as fun, apparently, every day. And even when I was walking in the village, people knew that, ah, these are the phrases the doctor knows. So let's try her on these phrases. When I was in the market, people was like, Alamuana! Like, okay, yeah. I will play the game again. But these things, together with all the difficulties, it's fantastic, and it's difficult, and it's fantastic, all at the same time. This is a picture just to show you what it's like when it's difficult, because I worked twice last year with the Ebola epidemic, and it was really difficult because we lost so many patients, and we lost so many children, and we lost families. I think that was the worst thing, that we lost families. And we were not allowed to hug, because it's a no-touch context when we're there to really reduce the risk of spreading the disease. So the only time when we could hug each other when things were difficult was when we were in our protection suits, like this. And then we had these moments. And these moments. So it really was the same, and it could be the same every day. It could be both. Sometimes this, and sometimes this. And this is Amy. She's a midwife and an Ebola survivor. She was infected when she was taking care of a pregnant woman giving birth. And she survived, and she was helping us now working as a nurse in the Ebola center. And she was fantastic. She was always cheering up the patients. And these are some of my other colleagues. Because if it is something I have learned when working in this context, it is that I really, really, really don't know the context. I have to listen to my local colleagues, my colleagues, who know the context much better than I do, and who can keep up being cheerful all the time. You see, they look happy. This is in the middle of Ebola. But we were really trying to do a good work, and they kept the mood up all the time. And I will actually save this picture for a little bit later. So what is the conclusion of this? Now, I came back, so I've been working in these three countries. When I came back from Congo, I quit my job at Karolinska in gastroenterology, and I started instead a residency in internal medicine at Danderyd. And I quit my research group, which was a fantastic research group, but just not for me. I want to do something else. So now I am a research, or you call it a forskar assistant, an assistant professor of global health here at the Public Health Sciences Department. And I'm now responsible for the course in global health that I never got to take myself. I did apply, but I was never accepted. I think that's why also maybe I couldn't let go of the idea of doing this. Anyhow, that's what I'm doing today. So right now I'm working with global health almost every day when I'm at Karolinska and in different contexts. I'm working with Ebola, I'm working with different non-communicable diseases, I'm working with education, and I love my job. And this is what I wanted to do, and this is where I wanted to end up when I was there 4 years ago, and I didn't really know exactly what I wanted to do, but I was not happy where I was. So it is possible to change your career if you want to. Global health needs a lot of skilled, talented people like you. There's a lot of room for people, but you need to find your own niche. Maybe you don't all have to write a PhD thesis on heartburn, but you can try. there seems to be not that many people doing it still, because they still call me when they need an expert. And I try to tell them, no, I can talk about Ebola, but I don't know anything about heartburn. That's someone else. But it is possible to do it. The trick is just to figure out when in your life, because quite often you do need to be able to leave Sweden to do it, to go out and see the world, to understand that otherwise you will be that stupid foreigner that I was with the girl with the fracture. My last pictures, these are just decoration, but I just like these pictures so much, I have to show them. So now we're back in Congo. This is a very small village in Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. There are tons of children, and there's nothing happening in this village, ever. Except once per month, the Doctors Without Borders airplane comes with drugs and supplies and some food for the foreign staff. And for some reason, it seems like the children know that the plane is coming even before we know it, because they're gathering around the airfield in the middle of the village. And they gather and they stand eagerly waiting there for the plane to land. And the first time I saw it, it's like, why are they waiting so eagerly? What do they want to do? What can they do? They have seen the plane land once per month since ever and ever, since they were born. But they were waiting eagerly. And we even had to hire guards to make sure that they didn't enter the airfield. As you can see, the guys in the yellow jackets. And they're even waiting in the trees. Everyone's waiting for the airplane to land. And this is when the airplane has landed. Everyone's running to see what's happening. What are they bringing this time? Are there any new people coming? That's my colleague Lex. He's a Dutch guy. And then when it's time for the plane to leave, to take off, we have to take the children away from the airfield again. But they're all waiting. The guards are standing there, keeping them from the airfield. And as soon as the plane has taken off, this is what they've been waiting for all day, that month. It's the time this month that they will play the game, catch the airplane. And they're running and running and running. And every month, so the first time I saw this, I thought it was fantastic. And it was so much fun, and I thought it was only this time. But then it kept happening month after month after month after month. And the same thing would happen. And they were so happy every time the plane would land to see this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Helena. That was a very interesting speech.
Thank you.
You told us about your previous career with heartburn and that you had a very promising career with that. What do you think about that today? I mean, since you changed your career into global health, you sort of descended a step or two on the academic ladder. How do you feel about that today?
I think it was pretty clear that I'm very happy with my choice. And I could not have done it in any other way, I think. I'm sure I could, but it feels like this was the way to go. But it's all about opportunities and the moment. You have to be lucky that in the moment you fit in somewhere. And I had the opportunity to join the Department here of Global Health. I'm very happy that I have my research background in something else and that I have a strong epidemiological research training. So I'm very grateful for that. And now I can apply that in this new context. So maybe it's a way of making what has happened to seem more logical. But now it seems like, of course, this is the way it should be done. I don't think everyone should do it my way, but find their own way.
All right, thank you. Now we're going to open up for some questions from you in the audience. Perhaps we will find time for one or two questions. So please raise your hand up high if you have any questions, and a mic will be given to you. Do we have any questions? It was totally clear what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to change into global health. Great.
Exactly.
Awesome.
I'm glad you got it. That's one.
We got it. All right, you can ask your questions more informally during the mingle, then it's not so many people here, so perhaps you won't be so afraid. Anyways, thank you, Helena, very much for being here.
Thank you.
So, after that very inspiring journey, we move on to our next speaker. And medical doctor by training, our next speaker is the research director at the Institute for Molecular Medicine in Finland. And he's the associate professor of biomedical informatics at the University of Helsinki. He's also currently a guest professor here at Karolinska Institute and has developed the web microscope, which is a cloud-based system for digital microscopy. At KI, our next speaker has applied this web microscope to infectious disease diagnostics and developed MUMIC, which is a mobile microscopy method to be used in resource-poor settings.
So, without further ado, let us welcome Professor Johan Lundin.
So thanks, Emily and Daniel, for the introduction, and nice to see you all here today. So as a young medical doctor, I founded a home call service together with some of my friends. And we were making home calls in the Helsinki region. And when you do, when you make home calls, you always carry your doctor's bag with you. So, and in the bag you have these essential tools that, that you are familiar with. So to view, to listen, and to measure things. This time there was no internet. So it was in the beginning of the 90s. And of course no GPS. So you got quite used to navigating in Helsinki. So actually you knew all the addresses and you could have maybe volunteered as a taxi driver. But we were kind of modern because we actually had a mobile phone. And that was not that big. It was really a good, but it didn't have internet, of course, and you couldn't look up in Google what you could do right now. So, but now today, these tools are changing. So, for example, there are already digital stethoscopes. You have digital otoscopes. And you have different kind of things to measure things that are connected and that you can use even at home. And what this causes is something called like task shifting. So you can shift the task. Actually, the patient can do things. A relative can examine the ear of a child and look for an infection and then send that information, or you can do remote consultation. And there are more and more of these connected devices, as you know. So this will make a change. There are even instruments that have so far been totally tied to the laboratory that now all of a sudden become mobile. So like a mobile ultrasound, or you can have a mobile ECG. Actually, these have all changed, but what I haven't found yet to be digital was the reflex hammer you saw in the first picture. That I haven't seen. But maybe someone will create that also. But then one crucial instrument that is used in all laboratories worldwide for many types of diagnosis is a microscope. So you use it for tissue diagnostics, cancer diagnostics, microbiology, for forensics, for education, for research, of course. So what has happened to the microscope? This is the one of the very first microscopes, the Leeuwenhoek microscope. It was actually quite mobile, if you look at it. It's a small device, and you can actually carry it quite nicely in your pocket. But today, microscopy is going more and more digital. So today you can scan microscopy samples, and you can create a digital copy of the entire sample, not only small areas in the sample, but actually the whole sample. And then you can view it through web interfaces or apps, and I will show you some examples. What is special with the microscopy images is that they are huge. So radiology is in megabytes, microscopy is in gigabytes if you scan an entire sample. So if you compare it to a football field, actually if you would print it on print a digital sample on paper, it would be a football field in size. So they are really huge. So you need special tools. And we have developed some new tools, if this video could be started. So let's see. Now you need to go back. Yes. Just click on the... Yes, okay. So now you also see our lab in Helsinki. So that's a tissue sample that you can then put into this kind of a scanner machine, and that can then perform the digitization of the sample. But then you can view the sample using your mobile phone, for example. So like we have created these apps that you can use for viewing and zooming in. You can, of course, use a tablet computer, and that is used now in education. It's very convenient, and students like it really a lot. Of course, you can use a desktop computer, a laptop, that's obvious. But then you can also now create these new interfaces. We have created this kind of interactive display table, so you can have a table as a microscope. Navigate with your hands, which is very convenient. You can even build a bigger size, even a wall-sized microscope. So it's really scalable. That's what we now call web microscope. This has also been now commercialized and transferred into a spin-out company out of the university. So what will happen to the famous symbol of biomedicine? I mean, if you symbolize biomedicine, the microscope is always there, or at least the eyepiece. So we would need to come up with some new icons. So maybe it could be something like this. Maybe not, I don't know. We'll see. And some symbols are really persistent, so you know that this is now the symbol of a phone, but there are no such phones anymore. So there are some diehard icons. What this digitization means, it will introduce a lot of new possibilities. It's not only viewing, it's also analyzing. So we can increasingly now use computer vision to do an analysis. And we can apply artificial intelligence to diagnose diseases, for example. So this you all know that for this type of computer vision you have all used, because you use face detection. You can detect faces, and it's really rapid. But now, during the last few years, this technique has evolved. So now you not only can detect faces, you can actually identify all kinds of objects in an image. And this will become more and more used in different kind of consumer devices. So these descriptions that you see are not written, they are computer generated. So the computer can actually create a whole sentence that describes the content of an image. And these are really efficient. So the latest version, for example, of Google Translate uses this deep learning artificial intelligence. So if you point your camera at a text in a foreign language, it can in real time change the text to another language. And it even works offline, which is really fascinating. So what we would like now, and what we are doing, is to applying this to biological samples. So we would like to create these kind of tools that could describe the content, for example, of a microscopy sample. And why would we do this? Because there is currently a lack of experts in the world. For example, this is Tanzania's Zanzibar president says that there is a lack of pathologists. Actually, in Tanzania, there are, to my knowledge, only 19 pathologists in the whole country. But this is not only Tanzania, it's actually also Sweden. So Sweden has also a lack of pathologists. Up to 10% of all Swedish pathology is actually performed in Hungary, so it's outsourced. So you need more of these tools. And of course, especially you need tools, new tools in a situation where you have diseases that need diagnostic, for example, at the point of care, like malaria is, of course, an obvious example. Often it's so that if you have successful preventive measures, that puts even more demands on diagnostics. So because you don't want, if fever is not automatically malaria, then you need to find out what is causing the fever. And then it's diagnosis. So here is an example also of the gap that is currently seen in malaria diagnostics. This is the percentage of patients who present with symptoms that are indicative of malaria. And this is the percentage that receive a diagnostic test. And here you see, especially in the African region, a huge gap. And this gap actually translates into there should be 100 million more tests per year done to diagnose all that have symptoms of malaria. And how do you diagnose malaria today? You do it typically from a blood test. So either you smear the blood out on a microscope slide and then view it under the microscope, or you can use these rapid diagnostic tests. But rapid diagnostic tests typically diagnose one disease. A microscope can diagnose multiple diseases. So that's the huge, and also microscopy is still the gold standard for this. So what do you see in a blood smear if you put it under the microscope? You see here is a white cell, these are red cells, that's a platelet. But here you have one red cell that has a dark ring or dot in it, and that's the parasite. So that is what you are looking for. But it takes a lot of time to view one sample under a microscope. So we applied instead, we digitized the number of samples, an area that is comparable to 500 fields of view in a microscope, which takes about 10 minutes to view, even for an expert. And then we used computer vision. So the computer vision analyzed the whole sample at high resolution and took out 100 cells out of 50,000 and presents them on an iPad. So then we asked the malaria experts, instead of viewing samples in the microscope, they looked at the samples on an iPad. So one panel with 100 cells for each patient. And this was very successful. This is what it looks like. If you are even a little familiar with malaria, it's enough to look at this one field of view, which takes a second compared to 10 minutes in a microscope. But the problem is now that we use these high-end scanners. So we have used equipment that is big, it's expensive, like these high-end scanners cost like 2 million Swedish crowns. So they are not suited for low resource settings. They are not suited for point of care. You don't carry this in your bag to a field setting. But fortunately, we live on the planet of the phones. So there are technologies now that become available, and now the opportunity is, for example, to combine the best parts of a microscope with a mobile phone technology, and then create what we now, in our project, call the MOMIC. We are not alone in this. There are many researchers doing this now. You saw, actually, if you noticed carefully before the event started, there was one TED talk on mobile microscopy, actually the paper microscope, which is kind of funny idea, but it's not digital. So we also really like to have the system to be digital. This was even called at some point the Kalashnikov, like something here. But there are various ideas, and that's great. Actually, this was one of the first microscope, Robert Hooke microscope. That is also a mobile, still a mobile microscope. But what is driving this, and what is the exciting thing, is the technology that has been developed within the mobile phone industry. Cameras especially, you can The camera part is a piece of extremely sophisticated technology packed into a very small size. And the camera that you have in more and more megapixels, they are more and more sensitive, faster, cheaper. So a typical camera like this one here could cost like $1. And the high-end ones, maybe in the best models, like in the iPhone, like iPhone 6, for example, costs about $15. So it's not that much. So actually, in my early experiments, I did various things in my actually home in my garage. So I transferred the camera to the front, and then I took out the lenses, and then I bought cameras from China. I bought some 100 cameras, and it cost only $400. See, and I got a whole bag of cameras, like a bag of chips. So now, then I of course turned into engineers that have now helped me to build a real serious mobile microscope. And this is what the prototype looks like. It is not the size of a mobile phone, but a little bit bigger. But it's really comparable now to a research level, laboratory level microscope. And it's connected, so you connect it to, for example, to a tablet, and the tablet is then wirelessly connected, so you can transfer data over this. And this is the size difference, so this is the scanner, that's the high-end scanner, this is the Momink. And if you look at the workflow, so this is the conventional digital workflow, scanning and then viewing. In the Momic, you scan with the small size device and then you view it, for example, on a tablet. Here are some pictures of captured with the high-end scanner, costs 2 million Swedish crowns, and this Momic cost of a smartphone. So they are quite good. It's not, of course, the same level because this contains really sophisticated optical parts, but it's coming closer, and you can definitely, in this cell tissue sample, you can easily distinguish the cells. And you can also count, for example, you can analyze them. So now we have this first field study that has been started where we use this in a field setting for diagnosis. And this is used in Tanzania in a small village outside Dar es Salaam, some 70 kilometers from Dar es Salaam, where we actually visited the clinic here some time ago, and this is what the small hospital looks like. And here is the laboratory. This is the lab where you perform microscopy regularly, and you actually have reagents for doing the stainings, and so electricity also, but not always available. And this is the kind of the situation where you would use the Momic. So that is what we are now testing. What is interesting, just some 200 meters from this small hospital, there was two mobile antennas, and four different operators available. And during my stay in Tanzania, I bought a 4G, like a modem, and I actually had, during my whole visit, I had a much faster connection than here. Because there was the network was not that crowded yet, but it's extremely good for transferring images. So we can transfer like a whole digital sample in just a few seconds. So we have now set up this link here from Tanzania to the Helsinki and Stockholm. So we can now transfer this data, and actually we can take a quick tour to see the transfer. So if someone can start this video, it would be great. So here, yes, so here we go. So here is Yombo, there is Dar es Salaam, there is Yombo. And then you can go a little bit closer to Yombo, and here you see what there is the hospital, the small hospital that we are. So now from this, as long as it takes now for us to fly with the Google Earth, to Sweden, that's the same time it takes to transfer a whole one sample of a biological sample digitized. So that was not that didn't take long. So actually, I could maybe show you some samples here if I can switch to the iPad. Let's see if it connects now. Okay, so yeah, that's actually not a malaria example, but it's a mouse embryo. But I can first show you this one. So they probably didn't send a mouse embryo here. But now I can, this is on the iPad like this. So now I can zoom in and you can see it. Now it zoom in, this is the kidney. So you can zoom in into cell level detail and then zoom out. This particular is a big image, so it's something like 200 gigabytes. So then here you can zoom into the small brain. But now I should show you malaria. So this is the 500 fields of view in a microscope. So if here again you can zoom in now. Now you start to see. Now you see the red cells. You see the white cells. But now what you need to do in a microscope, this is a typical view in a microscope when you view, and then you need to look for the parasite. So here, that is actually one in the middle. I don't know if you can see it. But this takes time. So instead, I can now apply computer vision to look to screen through this. So then the result looks like this. So this is the same sample. But now it has picked out only those that are suspicious to be infected. So maybe I can switch back to my presentation to finalize. Yes, okay. Yes, so I want to wrap up this by thanking my research group. About half of us are from the medical field, half are from technical field. And we try to speak each other's language. It's not easy always, but especially engineers don't like the uncertainty in medicine. So because you are not always sure, and that is not good for an engineer. We try to explain that, yes, this might be the disease, but we are not perfectly sure. Yes, and we have a large network of partners, of course, technical universities that we work with, and also then the partners especially in Tanzania and also in India that we work with. So where we then can, through this excellent network that KI has, we can perform these clinical studies using this technology. So that is really something that is good. And especially I want to thank Vinod, Diwan, who actually asked the question originally that, yes, you have this web microscope, but can you have it in your pocket also? Can you have the microscope in your pocket? So that was the initiation. And Lucy, as a prefect, has been instrumental, and also Agneta and Evert Linder, who, emeritus professor, who is a very, very interested in technology and always knows the latest what is going on. And Olli Kallioniemi is my head in Helsinki. He actually moves now to Sweden, so he's the director of Science for Life Laboratory. So he's a really excellent person here. And we are supported by grants from Vetenskapsrådet and from European level research infrastructure, EATRIS. And I want to wrap this up and end it by a few things that, please don't respect technology. Don't respect it, but use it for your purposes. And you should dare to tinker, tweak, modify, optimize, use it, combine technology in new ways. There shouldn't be anything that would prevent you from doing this. So try things that you think are good and go and create amazing new tools, because you can really do it. So by that I want to thank you all for your attention and be happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, Johan, for telling us about your very exciting work. In terms of innovations for global health, do you think that there are any specific fields within global health that would benefit the most from innovations in medical technology?
Yeah, I think, of course, diagnostics is obviously one really important field, and not only microscopy diagnostics, but various types of diagnostics is definitely. But there are, of course, really important other areas, and that's the implementation, for example, of technologies. That is not trivial. And also things like logistics. How do you get instruments to the field? How can you ensure that they are sustainable? How do you get the drugs? How do you get vaccines? So there are many other fields of technology that are also really important for this. So now I talk mostly about the instruments and gadgets, but definitely there are others.
All right, but just to be clear, you are a medical doctor, and yes. For future health professionals like myself, I'm going to be a doctor. Would I have to know programming? Would I have to know how to use the technology? Or how am I supposed to relate to that?
No, I don't think so. I mean, if you are following what is going on, there is this makers movement, for example, and there are many people that do various things, use technology. You don't need to be a programmer. No, that is not necessary. You can definitely use programs, but you don't need to program them yourself. You can combine. There are many, many ways of using this technology without being an expert in the field.
Okay, good. So I have a future, although
yes,
I tend to
forget. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. We have some questions from the audience, maybe. You just raise your hand. Over there is the question.
Hi. Thank you for a really nice presentation. I'm not a med school student myself, but I find myself being a little interested in how you can actually make, say, since you said pathologists are far and few between, how can you make the field of pathology more attractive to prospective students? That's my question.
Yeah, I definitely think if you look at the technologies that we are using in our lab for viewing with the table-sized systems and walls and things like that, and also all the different new deep learning techniques and this kind of artificial intelligence tools. I think the pathology should become more sexy, if you like, in the future. I don't know why it takes so much time to really move pathology into a new level, but pathology should also be more aware of what is going on in genomics and molecular medicine. So pathologists should, I think, be in charge of putting everything together in the future. But I'm not a pathologist, so if there might be a pathologist in the audience. So. Yes.
Do we have any other questions? Over there? Or over there?
A lot of questions.
Yeah,
nice.
It's really nice.
I'm over here. Hi. How close do you think we are from... My question is actually from the other end. How close do you think we are from bypassing pathologies completely and just like standing in a laboratory in Central African Republic and just like pushing a blood sample into a machine and then it gives me the diagnosis?
Yeah, that's really a good question, because there is definitely going to be a paradigm shift. I mean, it has been based on a person viewing the sample through an eyepiece. And that is a little bit similar, like, I mean, there's the human in between. Why should there need to be? And if you think of measuring temperature, you maybe at some point you measure by putting your hand on the forehead of a patient, and then, this might be fever. Instead, you measure it, of course, now. So it's a little bit the same. But it takes time, and in the first stage, it will be this combination, like human and machine. And that is what we also showed when we had the iPad with the panels of the infected or suspiciously infected cells. We asked the expert to make the decision. So the computer didn't make the decision, but the expert. But it took just 1 second to view the panel, which is, of course, a great advantage. But there will be this period of when we don't have enough examples of all the variations that can occur in a sample. I mean, there are so many things that can go wrong when you prepare a sample. You can have artifacts, staining errors, thousands of things that the human vision system is really efficient in filtering out. So that's the advantage of an expert, that you can have this longer experience. But their computers will catch up, definitely. and when they catch up, they are going to be faster, cheaper, and more efficient and available 24/7.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Johan.
Thanks.
I think these are all the questions we have time for right now, but Johan will be available at the mingle, so you can ask all your questions there. Thank you very much,
okay.
Johan.
Thanks.
Our third speaker has a background in political science. She is the president of RFSU, board member of the International Planned Parenthood Federation and the Swedish Red Cross. Moreover, she has worked with humanitarian aid through Forum Syd, and she is also a democratic consultant on both national and international projects. She has extensive experience with sexual and reproductive rights, gender and democracy issues. She has both lived and worked in southern and eastern Africa. Boy, I would like that CV.
Please welcome Kristina Ljungros.
Are you supposed to dance now? That's also my hobby, I can say. Thank you so much for inviting me. Do you know who this is? Ottar, Elise Ottosen-Jensen, that is actually the founder of RFSU, the Swedish Association for Sexuality Education. She was born in Norway. Her mother gave birth to 17 children. Ottar realized early how important it is to get knowledge about your body and to decide if you want to be pregnant and when to become pregnant. She was a journalist. She moved from Norway to Denmark, and then she moved to Sweden. And here, together with some medical doctors, but also others, she formed RFSU. This is a quote from Ottar. I dream of the day when every newborn child is welcome, when men and women are equal, and when sexuality is an expression of intimacy, joy, and tenderness. Ottar traveled around all over Sweden, and she gave lectures. She also helped women with contraceptives. But they did also set up a political program where they demanded the right to sexuality education in schools. This was more than 80 years ago, in 1934, they did set up this program. Another requirement was the right to abortion. Another one was the right to inform about contraceptives. That was not allowed at that moment. And the fourth one was to decriminalize homosexuality or same-sex relationships. Sweden then became the first country in the world to have sexuality education in schools. Woohoo! Isn't it? Yes, good. And in 1944, it was legal to have sex with someone of the same sex. And in 40 years ago, we got the abortion law almost that we have today. Before that, Swedish women did travel to Poland to make an abortion, and today the situation is the opposite. It's very hard to get an abortion in Poland, especially now we'll see with the new government there that was recently elected. A little bit about myself. I grew up in the northern part of Sweden in a city called Luleå. When I was 13 years old, I started my first organization working with environmental issues. I've always been involved with the civil society, with different organizations. I moved from Luleå to Stockholm, and I did continue to work with gender equality. And through that engagement, I got the information about the youth exchange between Zimbabwe and Sweden. I was then 19 years old. I had never been outside of Europe. And that youth exchange was for people who were young and who were involved in the civil society. I applied, and I got accepted. So we were six people traveling from Sweden and six people from Zimbabwe. So we spent 1 month in Zimbabwe and 1 month in Sweden. We were teamed up in this exchange, and I got a friend. She was called Patience, and we were in the same age. She stayed in the rural areas in a small town or village called Muturashanga, just outside Harare, the capital of Zimbabwe. We became really close, and we talked about a lot about life. By then we were 20 years old, and we had hopefully the whole life ahead of us. And I asked her what she wanted to do, and she said, I want to go to the university as the first person in my family. She has one younger sister and one younger brother and one older sister. And I said, I also want to go to university. None of my brothers has done that. And I said, I want to study political science, and she wanted to study economics. And then we went back from this exchange. We learned a lot. And when I came back, this photo is from the village. Her father was a teacher in the village. They were not that well off, but not extremely poor either. When I came back, I received an email from her, and she said, I'm so happy. I'll start at the University of Zimbabwe soon. And at the same time, I started to study here at Stockholm University. A bit later on, I came back to Zimbabwe, and I stayed at her place. By then, she stayed in Harare, the capital. And we talked a lot, and when the day was over, she said, I have to leave you for a while now. I'm going out for tonight. I was like, okay, what are you going to do? Well, I cannot tell you, Kristina. I'll be back soon. Just hang with my sister, you know her. I mean, we spend a lot of time together. And the day after, the same thing happened. She went out in the evening, and she came home very late. And when the same thing happened the third night, I asked her, what are you actually doing when you're awake? Can I come with you? No, you can't. I have to meet with this old man to be able to pay my studies. And that's also the way of paying for my sister and brother. I went back to Sweden, and of course I tried to support her, but I was also a student at the moment. When coming home, I realized that I was pregnant, and that was not planned. And I wrote Patience an email, and I told her, I'm pregnant, that wasn't my plan, I have to do something about it, I'm gonna go for an abortion. And then Patience wrote back to me, do you know what, I'm also in the same situation, I'm also pregnant, and I cannot keep the baby because of my studies. I went to the hospital here in Stockholm, and they helped me, of course, and Patience wrote me an email a week later. I'm really worried, I don't know what to do, I cannot talk to my family, I cannot talk to my friends, I'm really desperate, I cannot keep this child. And then she wrote me a week later and she said, I'm so happy, someone will help me and I'll get some pills, I don't know what it is, but I'll take them, that's my only possibility. And she said, please cross my fingers for me that everything will go well, I don't know exactly what it is, but this is my only chance. And then 1 week later on, I received a new email. Here I am, I'm not pregnant anymore, and I can continue my studies. And today, Patience stays in Johannesburg in South Africa. She has two children, and I stay here in Stockholm. I'm also having two children, and they are exactly in the same age. And she's working she has a career there, and I'm here. So, and we are still in contact. I met with her in South Africa just 2 years ago. And this is actually the case for so many women worldwide. Many people do lack access to abortion, and that is a human right, to get the access to be able to make the decision if and when you want to be a parent. But abortion is not legal in all countries worldwide, so almost 50,000 women a year die due to illegal and unsafe abortions. To make abortion illegal doesn't mean it doesn't happen. It still happens. It's just it becomes illegal and it becomes unsafe. And those who have to pay the price, especially young, poor women. ...800 women dies every day due to maternal mortality. Of course, it's due to the pregnancies and due to delivery when you don't have access to medical staff and trained staff. But another reason is the lack of the right to abortion and the lack to sexuality education. We have the largest youth generation now at this moment, and in many countries, young people are denied the information about sexuality education, but also contraceptives. 222 million women don't have access to contraceptives, And in many countries, it's hard for a woman who's not married or for a young girl to get access to contraceptives. And then we can see the result in terms of abortion, for example, and also that even children have to give birth to children. And this is due to norms around sexuality, that a woman who's not pregnant should not have sex. So it can often be hard to actually get the access and the possibilities, but also to enter a health clinic and to ask for it, because you're not supposed to have sex. And another misconception is that if young girls and boys or youths get sexuality education, they start to have more sex and they start to have sex at an earlier age. That's not true. If you get sexuality education, then you get to know what sexuality is, and then it's easier to make your own decision when to have sex, with whom to have sex, and when. That is also a human right. Oh, sorry. But it's possible to make a change, isn't it? We started our first international development program in Tanzania, as many other organizations. We started it together with a local organization, of course. That's always how we work. We saw that many girls who became pregnant had to leave school. So we started a school for young mothers, and we also started daycare centers for the children. But we realized that the girls continued being pregnant. So then we decided to shift focus. So we started to talk to guys and men about sexuality and gender norms. And then we realized that many, many guys and many boys saw it as something masculine or something as a good sign of being a man to actually make a girl or a woman pregnant. Through this project that we had in four different countries, we started to talk about gender norms, sexuality. What is it to be a man and what is it to be a woman? In these villages, we could saw that the teenage pregnancy rate did decline. We could also see that the STI, that the number of STIs did also decline. We could also see that the condom rate raised, and we could also see that girls started to take a bigger share in schools. We could also see that guys and men did start to take a bigger share of the unpaid household work. So it is possible to change gender norms, and it is possible to change norms around sexuality. But then we also have to involve boys and men. So this project is called Young Men as Equal Partners, even if they are maybe not so young in this picture. After that, we also started to work with elderly men. And you can find more information about it on the internet if you want to. Abortion is a hot topic, not only globally, also in Europe. These pictures are from Spain. Spain quite recently got their law with the right to abortion, but now, since some years ago, we have a conservative government in Spain, and they wanted to make abortion illegal in Spain. They wanted it to be illegal only if the woman's life was in danger, or if it was a result of a rape. But people got upset, both in Spain and worldwide. There were big demonstrations in Paris, in Brussels, in Spain, in Madrid. We went there to Madrid to support our partners in Spain. And the government actually had to withdraw this suggestion. And the Minister of Justice, the one that did propose it, he also had to leave his post. So it is possible to make a change. Woohoo! Isn't it? So, and that's how we are working today within RFSU, both on a local level, on a national level, and on an international level, with sexuality education, with advocacy work, with information campaigns to raise awareness of sexual and reproductive health and rights, which means the right to decide who you want to live with, if you want to have children, when you want to have children, the right to information no matter where you live in the world. So we are also part of a global network called International Planned Parenthood Federation. Our founder, Uttar, did start that 60 years ago. By then, we had presence in 8 countries. Today, we are in 170 countries working together with these issues. So as the last slide, I just want to show you the quote again. This quota is, of course, still relevant no matter where you live and how you live. And if you want to make a change, you can also join an organization apart from, of course, studying medical science and so on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kristina. It was very interesting to hear about your work and RFSU. I think that we have a lot of researchers here tonight. And, well, now you have told us about RFSU's very important work with advocacy and health policy. What role would you say that research play in RFSU's work on these topics?
We are working very closely together, as we've done for more than 80 years, and that cooperation is also very important. We also have people, we have a clinic here in Stockholm that you can visit, and you can also look for jobs there in the future. So, of course, we also have people within the organization with a medical background, and that is very, very important. But also to combine that with the work that is being done here at the university at the Karolinska, for example, the development of medical abortions, for example, and also emergency pills and so on. That is also something that we are using and that we are advocating for in our work, of course.
Right, great. That's awesome. I don't have to work with technology. So once again, we're going to open up for some questions from you in the audience. If you have any, raise your hand up high and our microphone will be given to you. No one? Oh, well.
Otherwise, I'll be there afterwards.
Yeah. You? Oh, we have one over here. Microphone, please. It's coming.
Hello. Thank you for a nice speech. I was just thinking, your background is different, I guess, than many of the other people who will be speaking or have spoken, as you are a political scientist. How do you think that makes, like, your perspective different? What difference does that make, do you think?
I think, as I just said, I think it's very important that we cooperate and that we are working together to combine our skills for the work that we are doing to make sure that everyone has their sexual and reproductive health and rights. So your knowledge and the knowledge that has been developed here at the university is, of course, extremely useful for us. And we also have lots of a wide network amongst politicians, for example, that we can use together. And I also know that people here at the university do have that. But we can combine that together. And we can also mobilize a lot of people, both here in Sweden, but also on a global level, that we can mobilize together for this work. So it's important. It's extremely important that we are working together and that we also, of course, follow your work very closely.
All right. I think we have time for one more question.
Up there, I think.
Maybe shall I change and start to study political science instead of being here at Karolinska?
Well, perhaps I should. Yeah.
I'm just kidding. It's very important to have
a... Yeah, well, Hans is here, you know. We're not starstruck at all. We're totally cool.
Is it? Really?
Yeah, totally cool.
Okay.
We see that he's actually working on something. We hope it's the presentation. We don't know for sure. We'll see. All right.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for your presentation. I heard you mention a few ways in which you tried to advocate for your cause. You said you joined demonstrations and stuff. But is there other ways that you use? Do you, for example, engage in dialogues with governments or, yeah?
Yes. Yes, of course. Thanks for that question. Yes, we do a lot. We work towards the Swedish government and members of parliament, also through, towards European Parliament and UN and so on. And we also do that in cooperation with our partners worldwide. We have a network of other organizations, and we've been working towards now the Sustainable Development Goals, for example, and we have a close dialogue with the Swedish government. And we also work with politicians on a local level. So we work on both local, national, and international level with both advocacy and sexuality education, just as Uta did. But I think we're having quite a bit different message now at 80 years later, hopefully.
Hopefully.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kristina. Okay, so we have one more speaker before we have a short break. So, we were very fortunate to convince our fourth speaker for the evening to prolong his stay in Sweden. Our fourth speaker is the director of the Indian Institute for Public Health in India. His main area of work is maternal health, and he has worked in various academic and research institutions worldwide and has authored over 20 publications on public health and health management topics. He has been a consultant for many agencies, including the WHO and the World Bank, and is currently the chair of the Technical Working Group of Maternal Health in the Government of India.
That's also quite a good CV. Please welcome Professor Dilip Mavalankar.
Thank you very much for inviting me here. With this music, I feel like a movie star's walking in a TV show, so I haven't done this before. I have given only academic lectures, but it is interesting to be here. Thank you. What I'm going to talk about is maternal health in India, progress and challenges. Let me introduce our institute, Indian Institute of Public Health. Karolinska Institute is a very old university, largest, and in some sense we are the smallest and the youngest university in India. We are only 4 months old. Our institute has been converted into a public health university, the first public health university by state legislature of the state of Gujarat in India. So I'm happy to be here giving this first talk as a university director. Thank you for inviting me. What I thought, I'll give you a brief history and introduce India to you in 1 minute. India is a 5,000-year-old history and longer mythology. We have the epics of Ramayana and Mahabharata, which are even longer. Now, we are a federation of 30 states, and our constitution says that we are socialistic, secular, democratic republic. So we are not a monarchy like you. So, even though we had more than 500 kings when the British left, we have 15% of global population, which is like 1.2 billion on the land mass, which is 2% of the land mass of the world. So you can imagine how crowded we are. Of course, Holland is more crowded than India. We are very hot and happening. You take the minus temperatures which you have in Lapland and convert just that number to plus degrees, we have that in summer. We are at 48 or 45 degrees plus in summer, when humans can also almost melt. Our economy is growing. We are a poor country, I didn't want to say that, but our economy is growing. Our GDP in PPP terms, purchasing power parity, is roughly 1/10 of what Swedish PPP economy per capita is. So we are almost 120 times more people at 1/10 the income. So that is a brief introduction of what India is. The history or discussion about maternal mortality in India should start with the building of Taj Mahal. The Queen Mumtaz, the Queen of India in 1641, died in the 14th childbirth through bleeding after death. And the king was so moved that he created this famous monument for love called Taj Mahal. And at least the picture of it you must have seen. Some of you, I'm sure, have visited. Some more I invite you to visit. But it is a monument of maternal death. The story doesn't end there. It took 20 years to build, and 20,000 people, artisans, laborers worked, and it bankrupted the country. So the son of the king was so upset because his father squandered all this money of the countrymen on his wife's monument that he took the father into custody and put him in jail in the last few years of his life, which is the real story. I'm not exaggerating a bit. If you are not sure, read the history. But fortunately or unfortunately, around the same time, the Swedish queen, Ulrika, had difficult delivery. She had difficult pregnancy, difficult delivery. Nobody in Sweden could probably help. So she had to get a midwife from Germany. And then she realized the importance of midwifery and told the Swedish doctors and people to develop schools of midwifery in Sweden. And that is why Sweden doesn't have Taj Mahal, but it has a 300-year-old tradition of midwives delivering women safely. We have high mortality, but Taj Mahal. You have low mortality, but no Taj Mahal. So, so that's the funny part of the story, ironic, but we have to learn from each other. Indian maternal mortality was about 100,000 maternal deaths per year in around 1990, which is almost 250 or 270 deaths per day. But serious maternal health and programs to reduce maternal mortality began with World Bank assisted program called Child Survival and Safe Motherhood Program in 1992. They started improving emergency obstetric care in rural hospitals, training doctors to give anesthesia, general doctors to give anesthesia and do cesarean sections. We also have shortage of obstetricians and anesthetists. So it's a common problem not to have specialists, especially in the areas where needed. Technical support was provided by Columbia University's Averting Maternal Death and Disability Program via UNICEF and UNFPA, where I was one of their consultants. The Millennium Development Goals, the compact between various countries, helped to focus attention on maternal mortality and maternal health. The Millennium Development Goal 5 focuses on maternal health and reducing maternal mortality. And by 2005, Government of India at that point developed enough political commitment to start a new program called National Rural Health Mission, which allocated almost $12-13 billion over 10 years to improve rural health infrastructure. There were cash incentives provided to women to go and deliver in a health center or a hospital. More than 500,000 villages in India had developed a system of health volunteers called ASHA to help women reach the hospitals and have the education needed to have safe delivery. Additional doctors and nurses were hired on contract because they were not easily available in the rural areas. Additional supply of medicines and equipment was also increased. There were other efforts. My state of Gujarat developed a large-scale public-private partnership because the situation was that not many obstetricians were willing to work in rural sub-district hospitals in the government system, but there were many private doctors and obstetricians available in the state. So they developed this partnership with 800 private obstetricians to conduct delivery of poor women free of cost to the clients. So started some ways developing a public-private partnership to provide care. And that reminded me, I had to give similar lecture in China. I said, it's exactly the same policy which Deng Xiaoping developed when he transformed China. He said, I don't mind whether the cat is black or white as long as it catches the mice. The principle was that whether the delivery is done by a government doctor or a private doctor doesn't matter as long as it is free and it is safe. So under that program, very successful partnership were developed. Similarly, Indian ambulances were very in poor shape, the government ambulances. So another partnership was developed with the Emergency Management Institute of India. And now, in last 7, 8 or 10 years, There are 700 million people covered by that single number ambulance calling system. And their pickup times are roughly average of 20 minutes. Within 20 minutes, they come and pick you up in anywhere in these 70% of India, which is a phenomenal change. We had a SIDA, Swedish SIDA supported program to strengthen midwifery, and which also developed the skills of nurses and midwives in India. The result was rapid increase in hospital delivery. Many first referral units were made functional, district level and sub-district hospitals. Caesarean sections rates in rural areas started it to increase. It was less than 2%. The recommended population-based caesarean section is roughly 5 to 15%. I just want to show you four pictures. This was the situation when the program started. Many hospitals and health centers looked like this. Women came, there was no mattress. With this new investments, hospitals started looking like this and like this. So substantial improvement in the public rural hospitals. And of course, this was the ambulance system which covers 700 million people in India with very good quality service of pickup and transfer to emergency hospitals. This is another picture of how the operation theater looked before the program and how operation theater looks after the program. It doesn't compare with Swedish operation theaters, but we have 1/10 of income of Sweden, so we shouldn't compare. What happened was the program started somewhere here, and you see this state by state. These are the states of India, major states. Rapid increase in hospital delivery from somewhere between 10 to 30% to somewhere between 30 to about 70%. And now almost it has reached 80% of women in India deliver in hospitals. Maternal mortality rate, which was close to 800 or 900, started coming down and went down to 167 at the last count. So it is substantial decline in maternal mortality also. But there are many challenges remain. This is last almost 10 years progress. We have been working in maternal health through various programs, averting maternal death and disability program with Columbia University funded by Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. Midwifery strengthening program funded by Swedish SIDA and MATIN, which was a research project to evaluate all of this funded by EU and where Karolinska Institute and Vinod Diwan's department is a active partner and PI. What we found is that focus is on delivering in a hospital, but we have neglected the quality of care, the emergency aspect of the hospital delivery, and the skilled birth attendant. Many of the nurses, midwives are not skilled. Doctors are sometimes absent and not skilled. So women have moved to the hospital, but skills are missing. Still, mothers die because of non-availability of emergency services within the hospitals. Sometimes non-availability of blood because of the scare of HIV. The government has made the blood transfusion so strict that it has become almost non-safe but non-available. Delayed and improper referral is another reason why women still die. I just want to show you from one of our works in MATIN project done by Dr. Yogesh from Madhya Pradesh. This is a district in Madhya Pradesh. The red centers are the functional emergency obstetric center. The yellow and green ones are non-functional, not fully functional. And that is why many women, if you see, this is the house of the woman. She came here and died. She came here and died. These are the women who died in that district. We have mapped using GIS to show how they are clustered. They have to go from one place to another place sometimes, and that causes delay and death. So there's a lot more work to be done still. Our research also showed that skills of nurses and midwives in the hospitals are missing. Dr. Sarika, who is finishing PhD at KI, has done an interesting study using vignette-based cases to assess doctors' and nurses' skills for maternal health. Our earlier work also showed there is gross inadequate technical capacity at the state and national administrative level for maternal health. You might be surprised that a country with such a size has only 3 people at the national level managing the maternal health portfolio of work, and many of the states have 1 or 1.5 person managing maternal health. So the top is very, very small. There is a saying the bottleneck is always at the top of the bottle, and that is where this is very greatly seen in India in managing maternal health. And all of this is because of still low political and social priority to maternal health, to health in general and maternal health in particular. Low budgets, improper human resource policies of posting, transfer, deployment, etc., make conditions such that doctors and nurses don't want to work in rural areas. And we have reduced maternal deaths, but still about 50,000 women die in childbirth every year in India. Inequities still persist. Maternal health use is lower amongst the poor and the marginalized. The poorer areas have high maternal mortality. The maternal mortality rate has declined, but the decline is 4 times faster in the richer areas as compared to poorest areas. One of the researchers, again from Matin, Dr. Bharat, he's doing his PhD. These are the findings from his work in India. Just to show you, Indian states are divided in the southern and richer states and northern and poorer states. And these are maternal mortalities for each. This is India as an average. This is the southern and richer states. These are the northern and poorer states. So inequity still remains, even though the rates have all come down and are coming down. The second important cause of maternal death after hemorrhage is infection. And cleanliness and infection control in our hospitals is woefully neglected. And that is compensated by overuse of antibiotics, and which in some sense, we had a study done in collaboration with Aberdeen University in UK, showed that there is almost 80% of women with normal delivery get one or more antibiotics. And 30% of culture positives we got from the labor room were resistant, bacteria were resistant to one or more antibiotics. So in some sense, because of this, we are looking at a specter of developing multi-drug resistant bacteria in the hospitals. Fortunately, Prime Minister Mr. Modi has emphasized Clean India campaign. We hope that it will help reduce maternal and child mortality by reducing infections. And there is also parallelly a national hospital cleanliness initiative started, which will reduce the need for antibiotics and hope that it will help in reducing antibiotic resistance. Finally, when all these young people have gathered from medical and allied subjects, I thought I will leave you with this thought that if you are interested in global public health, maybe select one or two topics of your interest and where you see there is a need in the developing country and develop expertise and work in that area. You can have opportunity to work on international collaborative projects, given that you are in a developed country in Europe. There are lots of possibilities and international projects going on. But you need to develop the sensitivity and understanding for the problems and the cultural differences between your country and the countries which you will go. You also need to find funders to support such work. There is less and less funding sometimes in certain areas, and especially for international work. Finally, you must document, publish, and disseminate, because that is what will remain and speak about your work, about your experiences. And finally, all of us need to do advocacy to change the policies, programs, and priorities, and also to act on those if we want to achieve really better international global public health. I want to thank the organizers and audience with this picture of our new campus, which is coming up of our institute in Gandhinagar. It's a 50-acre plot. We are building teaching capacity for 300 master's level students and residential accommodation for them and other amenities. I'm very happy to be here, and I'll be very happy to welcome you as students, interns, doctors, specialists, even young faculty to come and work with us in India on many, many various challenges and problems of the developing world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dilip. You gave me even more a bit of career advice there. But we have now heard you speak about the challenges with improving maternal health in India. So what do you believe is the most important quality to have as a future health professional, as myself, if I would like to work in maternal health?
Yeah, I think the most important attribute is to have patience, because things don't change very rapidly. And in some sense, ability to deal with uncertainties and unpredictability. Of course, the other sort of attribute which I don't have, and I felt now at end of my career that if I had, I could have made better impact, is how to do political advocacy. Because as scientists, as teachers, as medical professionals, we cure the problem. But the problem sometimes has the roots in the societal structure, societal power, and the people who in some sense are ignorant about your technique, technology, and science make the key decisions of the money and resources and allocations and whatever. So how to deal with the people in power and how to convince them is, I think, a skill which we need to learn as international health advocates.
All right. Yeah, that's definitely something to work on then.
So, do we have any questions from the audience?
Once again, raise your hand up high if you have any. Over there.
Over here, please.
Hi, thank you very much for coming over, and thank you for your speech. I had a question concerning advocating the maternal health topic at top level politicians in your country. How do you quantify the benefits of investing into maternal health?
Yeah, my sense is there are two answers. One is sort of World Bank answer, which is like you count money, how you save, etc., etc., etc. A health economist could do that. The other answer is ask your mother. If she wouldn't have survived, what would have happened? So the other answer is emotive, because politics sometimes doesn't move by the numbers, but it moves by emotive stories. So I think you have to build the capacity of both. One is the hard numbers. The third is people haven't used the human rights approach to maternal health. Some people have tried, but not a whole lot. If you look, compare maternal health and I always compare, because I never worked in HIV, that saying HIV, you have so much of money, you have so much of attention, so many stars talk about it, for something which in some sense a mother for no fault of hers dying. So, and it is only women die. So it is in that sense there's only disease, probably one of the few diseases where women die, and not a disease, a physiological process in which women die. So in some sense, we have to use various arsenals of argument depending upon the political people who are in power. But I have no clear answer. I haven't been able to convince them in India, so I should say that I have answer. But I think it is worth looking at how do we convince the political people saying this is unacceptable by any standard?
All right, I think that's enough of questions. And thank you once again, Dilip, for being here.
Thank you for inviting.
So now we've listened to these four very interesting speakers, and I think that you all have been seated for too long. So we have some instructions for you for the break, so listen carefully. We would like you all to stand up and turn to your neighbor and then discuss the following question. Discuss three things that made the greatest impressions on you during these last hours.
Or you can discuss or talk about what surprised you the most. And try not to be so Swedish and turn to a friend. Try to talk to someone new once in a lifetime. See this as a warm-up for the mingle. Yeah. We will break it off in about 5 minutes, and then Hans will go up, so stay tuned. Hello. All right, everybody. Our next speaker is eager to start. So without further ado, and I don't think I have to introduce him, here comes Professor Hans Rosling.
Can I have my image?
No.
Let's give it up to him.
Oh shit, my commentator.
Shit, what pains.
I'm not professor, I'm mästerläkare. I haven't specialized, I'm not finished yet. I'm in the end of my ST-utbildning, specialization as doctor. And what I'm going to tell you tonight, don't finish. There's a terrible expression in the Swedish language for students. Students who study, they want to be klar. Klar means clear. You would like to be like a vase of glass, which you can see through, you know. I don't like it. I never wanted to be a Costa glass, you know, like that. So very much about working with global issues, international issues, is about taking the opportunity that will arise. You cannot plan this work. You must take the opportunity that you get. And then you have to just say, I don't need to finish my ST-utbildning. I don't have to finish my AT-utbildning. One of the most successful Swedish medical students from Karolinska in global health is Anders Nordström. He doesn't even have a legitimation. He's not legitimerad läkare. Because he deviated. And then he became administrative head of WHO, and tragically the director general of the WHO died, and he was head of the World Health Organization. And he went to the G7 meeting, and he had negotiated with the world leaders, the two big world leaders, on behalf of the World Health Organization. He was then ambassador of global health, but he left and went to work in Sierra Leone as head of World Health Organization in Sierra Leone at the end of the Ebola epidemic. And we are happy that Lennart Hjelmåker is here tonight. Lennart, can you stand up and can we get a little light on you? Can we get a light on you? Because Lennart, we need light on Lennart, because Lennart is the new ambassador for global health in Sweden. He just started now. So, if you're interested in global health, he's more important than the rector here, you know, because he negotiates. And Lennart has a very long experience. He was the first ambassador who dealt with health. During the start of the AIDS epidemic, he was ambassador for AIDS and HIV and did a splendid job in that, having worked in Kenya, Zimbabwe, and now for a long time in Tanzania. Extensive experience for that. So I just tell you that there is an enormous career you can do if you choose to put your little life at disposal for global health. And that means don't finish. Don't, I have to do this first, then I will do it. I have to do this first, then I will do it. If you do like that, you'll never do it. This is very important. So I'm ST-läkare. I never finished, you know. Perhaps one day I'll finish, but I have 3 months left, but I never did them. And instead now I'll put questions to you. Because I found also that the teaching is not so good in global health and in school, about the world at large. I'm going to ask you a first question. Out of 10 persons in the world, how many have electricity? Electricity is very important for health. There are studies showing that having electricity at home improves the survival rate of children almost as much as vaccines. So in the world today, out of 10 persons, how many is it that have electricity at home? They can switch on a switch and they get light. Is it 1 out of 10? 10%? Is it 5 out of 10? 50%? Or is it more? I'll help you. It's not 100%. It's not time. Can I see by raise of hand, how many think that it's 1? Hand up. How many think it's 2? 20%. How many think it's 3? How many think it's 4? How many think it's 5? How many think it's 6?
How many seven? How many eight? How many nine? It's interesting. It's interesting because it's interesting that there's such a variation. It means it's not something you have as a group a clear idea about. Next is, out of 10 children in the world, how many get measles vaccine? And this is not just any vaccine. If you would provide any sort of health service, Médecins Sans Frontières, when they have to take care of refugees in a very delicate situation, the first thing you do is vaccinate against measles. Because measles in malnourished and children without health service is a deadly disease for one child out of 10 or two children out of 10. So measles is very important. But how many is it that get it? This is a delicate medical product. How many of the 1 years old in the world get it? How many think it's one? How many think it's two? How many think three? How many think four? How many five? How many think that 6 out of 10 get it? How many 7 out of 10? How many think 8 out of 10? How many 9 out of 10? That's interesting. I will not ask the next question because I see the pattern is more or less the same. It is 8 out of 10 that have electricity. It's 8 out of 10 or 85% that get vaccinated, and it's 9 girls out of 10 that go to school. You had the idea as a group average, you thought the world was as it was when you were born. You lived in vain. Because things are changing, and things are changing quite a lot. So what we can see here is that 80% of the world population have some sort of decent living standard. They have electricity, they get the kids vaccinated, they have the girls in school. That's not extreme poverty, that's out of extreme poverty. They also have food. And I'll put the next question here, which I used to ask about, how many children are there in the world? Well, there is 2 billion. It was 1 billion, less than 1 billion when I was born, increased like this. And then I used to ask Swedes, what is happening? Is it continuing like this? Is it slowing down like this? Or has the number of children stopped increasing and it's like this? And it's United Nations Population Division, who have a very clear projection. The other two are fantasies by me. And when I asked the Swedes like this, about Swedes answer like this. In Norway, they answer like this. It's Gapminder Foundation, and we run these surveys together in Sweden with Novus, in other countries with other web-based survey companies. It's very interesting we get so similar results, isn't it? People have the idea that number of children is increasing. You ask professionals, almost no one knows that it's this. You heard about RFSU, you heard about UTA. That's done for 8 out of 10 in the world. It's an enormous success. In many ways, sometimes harsh policies, but informally, people get access to this. And this means that 8 out of 10 have access to contraceptives. 8 out of 10 have electricity. 8 out of 10 vaccinate their kids. And I'm not happy about that. People sometimes say, I'm an optimist. I show a happy picture. Now, damn it. I'm very worried about the world. I'm so worried, so I go for the facts. That's when you're really, really concerned about the world. You're really worried. You can't accept it. Then you go look for the facts. When it's just about the personal feeling, oh, I'm so depressed, it won't work. Oh, no, I think it will work fine. That's emotion. Too much emotions about the world. Too much ideologies. You should have emotion. You should have ideology. I am not problem, but it must be based on facts, some sort of facts. I think that's very funny. This is, I lectured in Berlin 2 days ago for the heads of news in the European public service TV companies. And that's their result on this question. You can see how funny it is? It's exactly what I get when I ask chimpanzees, 33% on each one. It's absolutely random. It's absolutely random. It means that what RFSU was talking about, what Kristina was talking about, that right to have access to modern contraceptives, that exists not for everyone, but for most people in the world today. And if I, in Gapminder where we work, the foundation I started with my son and his wife, Ola and Anna, we work now for a fact-based worldview. Ola came up with a new concept. He says it's factfulness. It's an offer we make to the English language. It's a new word. We think we should go beyond mindfulness, you know, and be factfulness. It's a relaxing habit of only carrying opinions that you are based on facts. And see how proud I am. I see clear signs that the rich countries have come to the end of the post-industrial, the post-modern relativism, that everyone have the right to their opinion. No. People want to know basic facts. Huh? And then we can discuss based on those facts. There's problem enough in the world to discuss. Not that we should not be informed. And as you see, I'm proud that my son has a UDO from Lund University. You know the degree? University dropout. It's the same. He's very friendly with Bill Gates because he's also UDO, you know. You shouldn't be, you heard about, you asked a question about innovation. I heard a lot of things. Should I study this? Should I study this? Should I study? Now do it. The best thing of learning things fast is to teach instead of passing courses, trying to do things, you know. And sometimes you get too formal in universities. The biggest change of our time, I think it's this one. And this links very nicely to what Kristina was talking about. Number of babies born per woman. Back in history, it was 6. The normal number of children that humans have is 6. Back in history. And this is how it changed. When I was in gymnasium, when I was in secondary school, it was still 5. Changed very little. And then Paul Ehrlich wrote that book about population bomb, and everyone started to talk about population explosion. That is an ugly expression, because it means that you say that other people's loved children are terrorist bombs. That's why the book was called Population Bomb. 1968, the Americans had the nuclear bomb, and they said the Asians give birth to so many children that will turn communist, so it's dangerous for us. It's a very ugly terminology about this. We should reshape this. Because what has happened is this. It's 2.5. And a large part of this is in India. As you heard, India has been very successful in providing basic services for contraceptives so people can make their choices. And then we know that this will happen more or less. This is an enormous change. What is it? Is it data? I don't care about numbers. I'm not interested in numbers. I'm interested in human lives. But to understand humans' life, you have to use one thing is numbers. You have to talk to them. You have to understand them also. People say that I give life to numbers. No, I see lives through numbers. I see these enormous changes. This means that we have separated, just as Uttar said, who started RFSU, we have separated sexuality from reproduction. You can now one night say, darling, let's make sex, have sex tonight. And the other night, one year later, you shall say, darling, let's make a baby tonight. And we can choose those two most important things in life, the intimacy of sexuality between two persons, you know, can keep them strong together. And that marvelous thing that you can get a child and you can bring up a child, the two big forces in life. We can now enjoy them much more because we can separate them. They are not glued together and they are not kept together by religious institutions. I said not religions, I said religious institutions. Because religions will adapt. They will adapt. This is making too much noise. Huh? How many people are there in the world? This is how gap-minded divide the world into 4 parts. It becomes more clear. We are today 7 billion, 1 in America, 1 in Europe, 1 in Africa, and 4 in Asia. Respect for Asia. That's where most people live. I once got the task when I was in charge of all the international PhD students here at Karolinska. Everyone said, there are so many Chinese, they said. So I got the task to make a statistics on it. And I did this advanced method, you divide. I divided the number of PhD students with the population in their countries. And China came on 30 place or something. There are just very many people in China. There are also very many people in India. In fact, India will become the biggest country in the world. And those two countries are 40% of the world population. Of course, they will have many PhD students and many research collaborations here with us. You know, so what will happen? The PIN code is 1114 today. To know what's happened, we have to look at these different regions separately. In Europe, the number of babies born per woman fell like this. Started early, fell slowly. America, more or less the same. They had a baby boom after the Second World War, and then it came down to two. And Asia then, oh, this Asia, it's a population bomb. No. It's down to two. India, 2.4, 2.5 today. Number of babies, number of children in India have stopped increasing. In China, it is 1.6. And today, finally, the Communist Party of China decided to abolish the one-child policy. But it's long overdue. It was meaningless in the last 10 years. And before that, it was partly harsh. And it was not the rights of people were interfered with in a way that was not acceptable. So Africa then, is things changing in Africa? Never changing? Yes! And it will happen like this. We don't know really how fast Africa will come down, nor do we know at what level we will end up. Because today, you know, in China, there are much less children. And also in neighboring countries. I will come back to that. But look here. What will happen in 2050, we know. No more in Europe, because Europe is now on 2 children per woman. And America, no more people. In Africa, Asia, there will be 1 billion more. And by that billion, there will be no more fast population growth in Asia. Asia may even start to shrink in the middle of this century. Then Africa will double its population. Because you saw they were on 4 today. And by the end of this century then, there will be about same in Europe, same in America, same in Asia, but 1 or probably 2 more in Africa. And then I saw some faces say, oh, that cannot happen, that must be wrong. It's difficult to enter the heads of Europeans. Instead, you should learn from this. It's very clear, the message is very clear. Europeans should start being polite to Africans today. They will outnumber us. They will outnumber us. If they will be friends, if they will be partners, if they will be customers, if they will be whatever, enemies, whatever, you know, we should just not irritate them. Because we will be much fewer. And this is because this transition from large families to small families, started in Europe, then in America, then in Asia, then in Africa. But what about death rate? So many are dying in Africa. Mm-hmm. Every year there's born 135 million children in the world. 135. And the death rates of children today is tragically high, but it is about 6 million children that die. Out of 135 born, 6 dies. Child death has no impact on population growth in the world. The average, the life expectancy, medellivslängd, in the world today is 71 years. 71 years. What my friends, which I know the people in the United Nations Population Division, John Wilmoth, who's professor in demography at Berkeley, they are really sharp people sitting there. Many say, UN Population Division, you never know about this. Huh. They made a prediction in 1958 and said there would be 6.2 billion people by the end of the century, and they were 3% wrong. Can you imagine? 42 years prediction, 3% wrong. Amazing. We know more or less what will happen with this. And if we split this into North America and West Europe, you find what I call Gamla West, or it was a Swedish version here, Old West in English. The Americans call Europe Old Europe. I call it the whole thing Old West. That will be less than 10% of the world population. And 80% of the world population or more will be living in Africa and Asia. The center of the world will no longer be London and New York. The center will be Dubai. Most world trade will be here in the Indian Ocean. North Atlantic will be like backwaters. And this is difficult to accept. I'm trying to argue that we should build this Nobel Center, this big visiting center, because we will have so many tourists from Asia and Africa. And many of my professor colleagues, no, we don't know, we don't want visitors. It's too costly. We could find, damn it, if we charge 50 crowns for each selfie that the tourists from Asia and Africa will take on their kids on that stage, we can finance the whole building on that. They will come. The challenge is for the old West to integrate into the modern world. The catch-up is already happening. Let me show you this in my... I heard that Helena said there would be no bubble graph. Of course there will be bubble graph. How can you spread such a rumor, Helena? Here, each bubble is a country, size is population, color, red is Asia, blue is Africa, green America, and the yellow down here is European countries. And this is 1965. And what I'm showing here is two things. Number of babies per woman, as I did before here, 2, 4, 6, 8. Big families, large families, small families. This is 1965, 50 years ago. And here, length of life. Short life, 40 years, 60 years, 80 years. In 1965, there was one group had developed countries or Western world or industrialized countries. There were many names, but it was named for this group. Then there was almost nothing. And then this large group up here, which was called developing country. The definition for developing country when that term started to be used was having more than 5 children per woman. And now I'll show you what has happened. I will show you what has happened so you can see if there are still countries that fulfill that definition. Because if the whole world had changed, down to 2.5 countries, much changed. Look here, see how they're moving? They're getting longer and longer life. This is Mao Zedong's China there, going down. And now it's coming down with family planning very, very fast here. And this is Brazil. The Vatican say, don't use condom. They don't care. They use condoms. They come down here. They are coming down here. Indonesia, big Muslim country, started to use contraceptive. Now, RFSU told you problem for young people, but married people using it. India is coming down here. See, down to 3 here at the turn of the century. This Pakistan tried to follow India down there. And look here, Ethiopia. Look at Ethiopia. They are really fast going down there. And this is a completely new world. And this world, you see, this world is where 80% of kids are vaccinated, 90% of girls go to school, 80% have electricity at home. They don't live in just societies, especially, gender equity is a huge issue to fight for. But most countries are down there, but not all. There you have Congo. There you have Afghanistan. Here are the countries who lag behind. Many of them are in Africa, but many African countries are also down here. So you see, the world has changed. You cannot understand it as two types of countries any longer. And look here, when I go back and show you this in money. We heard from our colleague here from India now that you can fix a lot of things with money. In fact, I love money. I love them because I'm a professor in public health, and I know that the main determinant for good health in this world is money. Because money pays for school, money pays for good water, money pays for services. You can have human rights, that's fine, on Sunday and so on. You can ask for that. Monday morning, you need budget, you need salaries, you need to run things. So let me show you another way of looking at the world here. We'll change this graph here. And we'll take this one instead. There we are. And I just got a new laptop, so I don't know all the clicks yesterday. 1800s. There was not one single country in the world that had more than 40 years in life expectancy. These were the rich countries here. It was Netherlands, United Kingdom, Belgium, United States. Yes, they were great countries. They started the science revolution. They started the industrial revolution. They traded with slaves. They had their children down in the coal mine. Yeah, they were nice and ugly at the same time. Nice and ugly. And you know, if you look at Europe from outside, I've learned that working and studying in Asia and in Africa. When you look at Europe from outside, it ain't that nice. It ain't that nice. That's why we should be polite now in the future when we will be outnumbered. Otherwise, we can run into problems. And here I'm going to run this one also. I don't have any decent. There it works. So let me try to start and run this here. As the year passes by, can you see how they get rich? Oh, I have to explain here. It's money down here. You see, $1,000 there, $10,000 there, $100,000 there, and here, length of life. And the question is, if they do get richer, do they get longer life? In the beginning, no. You see, they just got richer, the European countries. They didn't get healthier. Why was it so? Well, it was that the start of the Industrial Revolution just benefited the rich. It was still unequal. Societies, you know, with kings and aristocrats and children in the coal mines. So not much, and we didn't understand microbiology. Public health was just starting. Here somewhere Jon Snow discovered that cholera was transmitted by water. Then we started to understand the importance of hand washing. We got better water, and by the end of that century, then health started to improve. And this, did you see? That's the Spanish flu. It jumps down like this. And then between the two world wars and the Second World War, and then the world came up like this. You see, this is more or less, you know, when I was a child. The countries that had been under colonial and imperialistic oppression, they were still down here. They hadn't developed socioeconomically. And the rest was up here. Now, you know, United States was there. This must be Canada, this is Australia and New Zealand, and these are the European countries here. Japan is catching up from behind there. You know, this is Brazil and Argentina. No, Brazil and Mexico, it must be, that get into a standstill because they can't operate the political system in an optimal way. And then the world becomes like this. Can you see China there with Mao Zedong? That's the big leap forward when he threw China down into famine. But then China came here and they got more and more health because they got education, electricity and basic health service, but no more money. They just went right up. And then Mao Zedong died and Deng Xiaoping said, let's go for the money. And now you see their countries all the way from Congo down there all the way up here. Sweden is somewhere here, you know, in this, and irritating Norway is there, you know, ahead of everything. And we have many countries in the middle. Now, how should we conceptualize the world? How should we look at the world? Let me go back here and look here. Here is the same graph, basically the same graph. If you cut the line at 13,000, you find that the countries above that are called high-income countries. This is sharp World Bank terminology. You cut it by 1,000, countries below that, they have 1 billion. 1 billion people, and they're called low-income countries. In the middle are living 5 billion people. Most of the world population are somewhere in between there. And I cut that in the middle, because there are so many. And then you get upper middle and lower middle. This is a much more rational way of dividing the world, because there the life expectancy is 59. Here it is 67. Here it's 74, and there it's 79. It steps. It's not two levels any longer in the world. There are many, many levels, and there's a continuous improvement. And you see why I love the money? As you get richer, you get healthier, you get healthier, you get healthier. But at the same level, you can be down here or you can be up here. That's public health. That's our discipline. And damn it, we were better than the economists. Because the average of the world is 70. The average of the world is closest to the best. But the economists down here left so many people in poverty. We won. Public health beat the economy. Because they have inequality in the world. And a lot of that, almost half the fall of child mortality in the last 20 years, is explained by female education. It's the achievement of improved gender equity that is half the explanation of this. The other half is the better technologies that we have. This is the disease burden. What sort of diseases do you have? Well, there are three types of diseases. It's the infections, it's the non-infectious diseases, we call them non-communicable diseases, and the injuries. And in this high-income countries, most diseases are this. You know, cancer, cardiovascular, stroke, psychiatry, and so on. And there's very few infections, and these are injuries. This is both counting life years lost and disabilities caused. And if you go to next one, it's still mainly non-communicable diseases. Here, infections get bigger, and down there, infections dominates. Can you see a disease transition we have? And that makes global health very interesting, very challenging. I started to go to work in Africa once upon a time because I wanted justice for the world and I thought I should do some service. But I was caught by the intellectual challenge. I found it one of the most demanding and interesting disciplines within academia in medicine. Because you have to think about more things than when you study things in the richest countries. You know? Medicine per capita is $500 there, $100 there, $40 there, and $10 there. These enormous improvements that the pharma industry in India has achieved, where they have brought down the cost of production of it. And those arrogant big pharma industry call it generics and call them that they copy. It's not. It's brilliant innovation. They brought down the price of the intraocular lens from $200 to less than $1. They are now doing, it's not less market economy, it's more market economy. Instead of monopolies, they are fighting, competing several different companies and really improving it. And that's why the HIV, access to HIV drug wouldn't have happened without the very competent pharma industry in India. So make no mistake, as we heard honestly here, India is a poor country, you can say it still, in money, but in human brain and capacity, wow. I studied in Bangalore in southern India in 1972. I was 24 years old, in the middle of my medical studies. We took half a year off, my wife and I, and we traveled. We fixed our own exchange program. I sat down in Bangalore at the X-ray round in the morning, and we saw a renal angiography shown, and I saw the kidney cancer, and I said, why wait telling, see if they know it. 20 minutes later, I was almost embarrassed. The medical students of India knew a lot more than me. I was like a nerd when I was studying. I was in the 25% best. And in India, I fell from the top to the bottom. And I asked them afterwards, are you really medical students or are you specialized doctors? No, we are medical students. We are the fourth year medical students. And I said, how come? How come? I said, what book do you read? We read Boyd. They said, oh, that's the thick one. I said, yeah. Yes, it's very thick. How many times? We read it about three times, they said. And we read Verke, thin one, once or one and all. We had much better parties, Indian friends. We had much better parties in Sweden, you know. We really, life as a student was better, but you know, when it came to serious study, already then, you know, India was very serious. Look at those you heard. Helena, where had Helena worked? She had worked in Liberia, in Sierra Leone, and in Congo. And I know one more country you worked in, You worked in Norway. See, she's like extreme. Earned the money there to be able to afford to work for Médecins Sans Frontières down there. That's a sort of a trick you can do. And then we take the next Johan. We heard about studies here in Tanzania. We heard Kristina telling us about South Africa and Zimbabwe. We heard Dilip talking about India, and yes, Kristina also talked about Spain. And that's very typical that Kristina involved a country when it was technology. Kristina working on sexual and reproductive health, you have problems from here all the way up there. It's really, you know, it's not enough that married couple can have contraceptives. It's about youth. It's about rights for this. It's about safe abortions and all these things that need to be improved in reproductive health. Whereas extreme poverty is down in that end, and down in the poorest end. That's where you have most of the health problems. So let me show you the income distribution of the world. The income distribution of the world can be shown like this. Here we are. This is the people of the world. And unfortunately, these fonts are so small. This is $1, this is $10 in the middle, and this is $100. And this is back in 1800. Almost the entire world was very poor. Was in extreme poverty is very well defined. Matthew 6:11 in the Bible. Matteus 6:11. Vårt dagliga bröd giv oss idag. Den enda raden jag behöver är Bibeln. It's my favorite line in the Bible, you know, because it's about life here on earth. And that is the definition about extreme poverty, when you don't have enough food to eat. So back then, 85% of the world population were living in extreme poverty. And then this is what happened. In the beginning, see, go from 1800 to 1850, not much happened, because the beginning of the Industrial Revolution just benefited the rich. But then, you know, they got out. And you can see that we got, after the Second World War, somewhere here, when I started, this is when I started medicine, then there were two humps. You had here, you had Asia, this is China, this is India, this is Africa, this is the Americas, and this is Europe. And there were like two humps, the rich and the poor. Except that it was with number of babies per woman. Except that it was in health. The world was divided into two. And now it's coming together. It's really coming together. Because if I grab this here, I can show you that the rise of China and India made this happen. It's quite beautiful, isn't it? Huh? You see so many people living there in the middle. This is China, this is the United States, you know? And you can see now that the poorest in the United States, they are lower than the middle in China. And when this continues, the world will change enormously. In your professional time, the world will change enormously. See again, the poorest, the richest, the big middle, the lower middle, the upper middle. And I can show you how this look out. Here they only have fire. You know, here they get a light bulb. Here they have a bicycle, motorbike, washing machine, car, and fly on holiday. So what about extreme poverty? I spent most of my life studying extreme poverty. This is what it is, not having enough food. I took this photo during a drought in northern Mozambique in 1981. It's grandma who had prepared the food. The beans are already finished. It's only a stiff porridge which is left. And you see the pattern you had. Two parents there, they had five children, one died. Population growth was there, child death was high. To get out of extreme poverty, we know what's needed. It has happened for about 90% of the world population is out of extreme poverty now. Those girls shouldn't carry water, they should go to school. And they can do so when Mrs. Tapo have started her company. Can you see? She has a logo here. Mrs. Tapo, and she is now enjoying the benefit of the Industrial Revolution, a wheelbarrow. And she brings home water that would take five persons to carry. That's what economic growth is to me. Economic growth is increased productivity for the individual person in their life. In one effort, in one time, they can do more. Then they can move over and have only two children per woman. And that takes place with female education, increased productivity, child survival, then contraceptives, right and value change and political commitment. This transmission is transition is very important. Away from poverty. This is a woman we studied in Malawi. She said, I want school, I want health, I want infrastructure, I want my rights, I want my cell phone, I want agrotechnology, I want credit. She wants all of it. And the market drives me forward. But I don't want to be a small-scale farmer. It's boring. It's risky. I want to have a job. Come and invest in my country. I have a dream. I want fertilizer, cement, electricity, and mattress. She knows what she wants. This is what made me into global health. 1979 to 81, I worked in Akola district in northern Mozambique. I signed up to go and work directly for the government on government salary as the doctor there. We had 300,000 people, we were two doctors, and we had 3,000 children that died every year. The size of this was the same as Gävle County in Sweden, Gävleborgs läns landsting, where we had seven hospitals instead of one small hospital. Same population, 800 doctors, and 30 children dying. This is what have followed me through life. Two zeros more there, two zeros more there. I call it double zero traumatic syndrome. How to understand two serious difference. That they, when I went to work, I could feel back in Stockholm 100 doctors was going to work. And when they came to work, they had 1% to do of what I had. You can't imagine 10,000 times resource differences. Yeah, human rights are nice, but it's all about money. If you would move it wrong. When you have the money, it's not enough. As you heard from India, you need to have public health institute. You need to have the knowledge. You need to use the economic growth that is now coming so good in India. That has to be wisely used. This has been shocking to work in this reality. Here is me, the younger version of me, treating a woman. This is Mama Rosa, the midwife I learned so much from, treating this woman. Can you see that anyone can make the diagnosis? It's a woman who come in about 10 days after childbirth. And she lies and she looks like this. She show her teeth. Risus sardonicus. The sardonic smile. This is tetanus, stelkramp. Because of a childbirth, which we heard the fight in India to get rid of this, you know. And this is our emergency ward where we took care of children. And this was really tough. You know, the staff was good, but they had about 4 years basic schooling and 1 year professional life. And in the midst of that, we had an epidemic, so I became researcher on this disease, Konzo, that we could isolate. And here is from Tanzania. I have the right to show this figure, this photo from the family. I studied the disease out in extreme poverty. The family didn't have enough clothes to come out, everyone at the same time. They had bartered their clothes for food. I'm not talking about developing countries. I'm not talking about developing world. I'm talking about the end, the poorest of the poor, which is less than 10% of the world population. Don't think developing countries. You know, there's such a range. There's such a range. And this is, to me, still the task, the main task for global health, to fix it. Because when I came back in 2011, after 30 years, my wife and I went back, the population had doubled. And the number of doctors has increased to 16. That's quite a nice growth. The child deaths had decreased when I used an international estimate. But up in the northern part of that district, there were still two doctors for 300,000 people. Can you see how extreme poverty replicates itself? Out in that poverty, because that's where you have the population growth. That's where you still have 5 children per woman. And this is the same room as I showed before now with a very competent staff there. They were treating HIV patients there. And here is the doctor who have my job sitting in the same room I was sitting. And my wife said it was the first time for a very, very long time that I kept quiet for 1 hour and just listened. He was so good. He was so good. And he had everything under control. That's what I see. The talent of colleagues in the poorest countries can never be underestimated. He knew what he was doing. I don't have the resources. My wife is a child psychiatrist. She asked about attention deficiency hyperactivity syndrome. Oh, I have them. I see them every week. But I see them as surgical patients because they are beaten, those children, or they have run out in the traffic and they are hit. We can't afford the drugs. And especially we can't afford the psychologist for this. He knew his entire district. I think I leave it by that in respect for colleagues working under those conditions. As you heard, we have been humble if we come from the rich end of the world. We are welcome to work in global health, you know, but we have to be humble and cannot be organized for us. But it's, we can bring resources to this and take every opportunity you have to be able to work in the poorest part of the world, because that's very important to learn. It takes quite a lot of time to learn it. Helena, did you tell about those children with the plaster of the leg? She told you when she wanted to be nice and take the child home. You know, it takes time to learn those things, you know. Working in poor societies is not less demanding, it's more demanding as a professional, because you have to think in more dimensions, but it's very stimulating. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Hans.
All right, we know that you're on a tight schedule. We've heard that you have a BBC and an interview. But so to go to the critical question, we all want to go abroad. We all want to get the experience. We want to be enlightened. We want to know more about the new world. But when during the time, during your lifetime, are you supposed to, when is the cue to go?
Are you single?
You know, my
that's very sorry. Yeah. Sorry for being so brutal. Oh, no, sorry. No. He's flushing very nicely. He's flushing very nicely. Huh?
My girlfriend is actually in the audience. So yeah.
And she saw him flushing. It was very nice. This is a good man, you know. He's a good man. He flushes.
Sorry.
You know? And he got. He's selected because he speaks so well, and then he got speechless. Because that's how it is. There are things which are most important in life, which you don't compromise. So working internationally, traveling in the world, is about that closest life. I can talk about bravery and doing things, but it's about life. And therefore, I have developed a model for life. Life can be very complicated, but I simplify even life. Look, here, I'm going to do it here. Life starts here, and then it goes on like this here, and then it finishes there. It's fair. It's straightforward, isn't it? You can't stop time, you know. And in the middle here somewhere, let's say you are 40. Here you are 20. And here you are 60. I'm scary. I'm close to this end here. This is life. Now, what is most important in life? That's your life. It's the other ones. It's what makes him flush. That's what's important. But in the beginning, it was not that partner, it was your father, and probably, this is a generic life, I don't go into the details, and the mother, they go very closely, and then somewhere here in the teenage, you get a lot of conflicts with them, and then they move away, and you go and see them with some intervals, and they live their lives up there, and you rush up out in life, and you are your own, you know, and it's fantastic, and you're on your own, and then that's boring, and then she or he comes along from this end here, you know, these fantastic moments happen, and they come, and then you get fed up and they disappear. Then comes a new one, and that stays along, and then, baby, darling, let's have sex tonight. Darling, let's make a baby tonight. Yeah? And you can have children, you know. You can have children. And this is the most fantastic, that between two lifelines like this, these children can come and they get close to you like this here, and they get close to you like this here. And then after 15 years, remember this thing over here? That repeats itself, and these teenagers become quite cumbersome, and you are like satisfied when they move along, you know, and they live like this. And the two of you, you know, go on with your life here, and it would be very nice after the children have left, but you divorced. This was not another one. It's another person. Okay. And then someone else come in here, you know, and you get like this. Sometimes another person can come here and become very important, like this can happen. Or your parents get very sick and they pass away like this, you know. So this is a typical life. Now, when can you work with... Did we have a red one? Yes.
Yes.
When can you work now with global health? When can you leave your country, go away to another end of the world? You can work there, preferably for longer periods. Our Indian colleague didn't say that, but go and stay for some years. yeah? Because that's how you get used to it. This is a good period. But then you have very junior exchange students, take the global health course, do things like that. This together, you can do things here. When you're single again, you can do things. When you fall in love, it's like very sensitive. You know, you can't ask her, should we go to Africa? You don't know whether it's better wait a little, you know. And then there's a good thing. Then you get the children. Children is the big change in the world. You have to decide who goes up in the evening. That's the test for gender equity. That's really serious. So you leave that. But this is a nice period, you know. You are like a box. Life is this. You can move that box, you know. But the problem then is that both want to have a job at the same place. Then when these teenagers come, that's not good, and this divorce is no good. Here you can go again, and then you can go here, or you can go here with this person here. Instead, you can do a lot of different things. This is more or less the life. So you have these. Don't miss these opportunities. And what you can see, I've done such a lot of recruitment, and people tell me when you select someone to get this fantastic job, this assignment where they want to go and do it, they come up with three reasons why they can't take the job. Reason number one, I'm single. But you know, I have someone, but I'm really single, and I can't leave now. That's too risky, you know. This is number one reason. Number one reason, you can't go because you're single. Huh? Number two reason, well, you know, we are together now, you know, so I can't go. Had I been single, I would go. This is reason number two. And we don't know whether we should have children or we should. Had I been single, or if we had had kids, then we could go. But now, you know, I have to be very, very careful. And the third reason is, of course, that we have children. That's why we can't go. So it's always one of these. It's always the closest thing in your life. So be very careful when you choose your partner. Be very careful when you choose your partner. And don't buy houses. Don't put yourself in debt. Don't do that. Then you can choose this one.
Thank you. Well, it seems like me and my girlfriend has a lot to discuss and talk about. Yeah.
Yeah.
Where are you? Is it here?
Well, I'm hoping that we will go in the long haul, of course. But I think we're
you're there. Yeah,
I'm a bit young, you know.
Yeah. That's nothing to be worried about. It will solve itself.
It will solve. All right. Oh,
that's the least thing to be worried about.
Well, yeah. So awkward with my girlfriend here and her big sister as well. So great for the family.
Yeah. So Hans, you ended with talking about the past, and now we want to talk. No, I mean, sorry. You ended talking about the future, and now we want to continue on that theme. So, if you please would stay up on the stage while we introduce the next speaker, because we know that you know her.
Oh yes, I know, yeah. And I know where she is on that one.
Ooh. Oh, great!
And interesting.
She's a very wise person. She's a very wise person. Listen carefully to her.
Yes. Yeah, so let me introduce her first. Our last speaker will hold the closing speech for Global Health Night. She's an associate professor of infectious diseases at Karolinska Institute, who has worked cross-disciplinary with global health-related issues for more than 15 years. Her scientific work on HIV has resulted in several original findings and technical developments. In 2014, she was in charge of the construction and management of the KI Ebola Center. And for the past 6 months, she has been working with the WHO Ebola Response Team, currently with the development of the new Global Health Emergency Workforce.
And as you can see, Hans just wants to listen, so that's exactly what we should do. Please welcome to the stage the last speaker, Taha Hirbod Alexandersson.
Thank you. Look at you, you're all inspired, as am I. I've listened to Hans 15 years ago, almost 15 years ago. I heard similar stories and I'm still as inspired. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to see this aula filled with people interested in global health. So good for us, good for the Karolinska Institutet, finally. You've been inspired, I hope, tonight. I hope you've heard a lot of stories that you will take home. I hope you've all reflected the same way as Daniel and Emily have done. What's in this global health for me? Where can I contribute? It can't be big. It's a big and vague subject in some ways. Some tackle it, like Johan, with the technical developments. Some speak about the poorest of the poor. I'm not going to be able to give you, within these short minutes, the technical details of the work that I've done, but I would like to give you two examples and two short stories to see if I can provide you with a tool that can help you this evening when you start reflecting about these things, or even at the mingle. I know you need to go to the mingle soon. So let's go. HIV and Ebola. Those are the topics I'll be talking about. Obviously, HIV is what I've been conducting my scientific research in for the past 15 years. I know a lot of you are medical students. I'm sure a lot of you are not medical students. I'm a biomedicinsk analytiker, and I'm working with disaster medicine at the WHO. So take home message, doesn't matter where you start, as long as you start working with global health issues. And sorry, I'm glad Hans brought his bubbles. I have my bubbles too. I mean, I'm speaking after Hans. Unfortunately, my kids are only 2 and 4 and not like Ola, so they're not as fancy as his. They don't move around. We'll get there. First graph that I'm going to talk about, I'll use two graphs to tell my story. This is from a cohort of HIV-infected female sex workers in Kenya. On the y-axis, you have a logarithmic scale of HIV virus copies, and on the x-axis, you have a number of years infected. The first graph that I showed you was a micro-level story. The second graph is a macro-level story. Here we're talking about the Ebola outbreak, which occurred for the past 12 months, or 1.5 years. Jesus, it's almost 2 years soon. On the y-axis here, you have numbers of either dead, which are the blue bars, sorry, the numbers of probable cases and confirmed cases, so Ebola numbers. This is the Liberian graph. The line shows you the number of beds, so the international and national response to the Ebola outbreak. So here we have a macro level. So I'll tell you these two stories, and let's see if we can draw some conclusions. So I told you I'm not going to go into details, but rather provide you with some tools. So the tools that I'm going to be using and that I use to assess these questions, what takes you can use regardless if you're looking at a micro-level question or a macro-level question, is something called systems thinking. When you use systems thinking and you use a strategic way of addressing questions in global health or whichever topic that you choose, you don't necessarily just stick to the event, the tip of the iceberg that you're seeing. You start looking at and scrutinizing the underlying patterns, the underlying structures, and the mental models. And you will see that my talk is going to focus very much on the structures. Okay. Event number one. What did I observe? Well, I was recruiting HIV-positive women as a control group, actually, to HIV-negative women in the female sex worker cohort that I was working in Nairobi, Kenya. And I wanted HIV-infected women that were not on treatment, because I'm an immunologist. I'm interested in the immune environments, and I wanted to look at immunological effects that did not have to do with antiretroviral treatment, but the actual body. I'm pretty sure you know which bubbles stood out, the ones on the bottom. We have a term for this in HIV research, that when you're not on treatment, but you're controlling your infection, you're called an elite controller. I was 27 years old. This is my Nature article, right? In my small sample size, I had found this many. So the size of the bubble, same story as Hans, is the number of population. I have found this many elite controllers. Come on, that's a Nature article. It's amazing. It's not true, right? I mean, not all stories end happy. This one did, but from another perspective. When I talk about patterns, and we've heard this so many times this evening, it's also patterns that you can observe through these companionships and through these partnerships with our colleagues in the world where this stuff is happening. I was sitting in my lab bench. All I could see was some amazing findings. It was when I started working with, I don't have a pointer, so that's why I keep pointing with this. And I'm not using that, I'm not there yet. When I was discussing this with my colleagues back home, I figured after all, we have amazing laboratory facilities, so let's send this to the lab next door. And we did some HPLC analysis and some chemistry analysis, and we could see that, no, of course they weren't elite controllers. They were all taking the drug. They were just not saying it to us. So they'd been recruited. We spent a lot of money on this, collected biopsies. They were in this big program. They've been lying about receiving antiretroviral treatment. So if you skip the middle part there, if you skip the structures and you jump to the mental models and you start talking about assumptions and beliefs and values, you can very easily start talking about how these female sex workers they're liars, right? It's a cultural thing. Must be something. Why are they lying to us? Can we trust anything that they say? And then when you start looking at the structures, you realize that 5 minutes away, there's another clinic that's handing out a bag of food with the antiretrovirals. So the aid organization boom in a lot of these low-income countries, within 15 miles radius, you had 12 different clinics, all with different programs. One was handing out food, one was handing out the other thing. We were providing free healthcare. So the mental models and the structures that were there, we had put in place because we were chasing numbers. The aid organizations wanted numbers recruited in their programs. So all these different things were happening. So my example from my 15 years of research in immunology on HIV, I could show you our fancy pictures in collaboration with Johan, Lundin, actually, with viruses and cells. But my take-home message and what I learned through this was sitting around the table, thanks to our partnerships with these other clinics, and working out common strategies of how to collaborate within this community. So, previous story, a micro finding leading to a macro solution. Here we start vice versa, we start on the macro level. So I told you the blue bars, the light blue are the number of confirmed Ebola cases in Liberia. The dark blue bar, this is WHO numbers, the dark blue bar are the probable cases. So we don't have a confirmatory laboratory test, but these were most probably Ebola infected. A lot of criticism, fairly so, has been targeted towards political organizations such as WHO and other political organizations. Where were the responders? Where was the international community? MSF doing ridiculously amazing work for so many months, screaming, and nobody was listening. That's the political side of it. It's technical and other issues as well, but that's political. With all fairness, we don't know what will happen at the next outbreak when it comes to the political side of it, but at least there's a reform ongoing, so positive work will hopefully come out of that. But I'd like to go step down a bit. If you see my arrow pointing up there, can't really see it that well, but if I go back and forth, you can see that it's pointing towards mid-July. So mid-July, numbers were still quite low, right? This is when the first initial calls were made from the foreign or emergency medical unit that I'm at the WHO. You guys, you responders to earthquakes, tsunamis, all these sudden onset disasters, who are a surge. Some people call them the second surge, the second disaster, because there are so many people that want to help. Can you guys help us with the Ebola outbreak? Can you guys come? So if you look at my pretty pink boxes there, to the left-hand side, you have the period between MSF calling for help and these first initial calls were made. On the right-hand side, 2.5 times longer period is the period from when these calls were made to these international organizations and when the peak in the numbers of beds actually happened. So peak in number of beds is basically available treatment. So what are the mental models here? What are the structures here? What's influencing these patterns? We can focus on the political part. We can focus on the behavioral part. We can talk about how West Africans do not want to talk about the Ebola outbreak or they're hiding their dead. Or we can also talk about our own mental models. We can talk about our own fear. We can talk about how easy it is to respond to an earthquake because it happened. The reason I'm talking about earthquakes is because Nepal earthquake happened 3 days after I started working, so I've been involved in that. As a biomedicinsk analytiker, I was very good at it. But we can also talk about our own mental models and try to look at the structures that are influencing these patterns for us. So what we started to do here at the Karolinska, which I think was amazing, was the most cost-effective of these things that now the lessons learned documents are showing. They're showing that you need safe environments to work and you need safe places for your workers to live while they're working. And you need medical evacuation. If someone gets sick, you need to be able to put them on a plane and fly them back home. Those are the things that they need. But most importantly, they need training in infection prevention and control. They need to know these things. And this is what we did at the Karolinska, and I think you, hopefully, and the ones that have signed up for Johan von Schreb and Anneli Eriksson's workshop will hear more about that. So, we've heard about maternal health, we've heard about working with the event, working directly at the site, we've heard about technical developments and so on. I'd like to give you my message, if I may be that senior. You don't have to choose 10 years ahead what you want to do. But you do need to make a choice what you want to do today and for the next maybe couple of years. Because you need to gain a lot of knowledge. But once you have that knowledge, you don't necessarily need to spend it within that same area. You can use it elsewhere. And if we're talking about working as a doctor with Doctors Without Borders and treating the patients on the clinical side, or if we're talking about the underlying structures, you don't need to choose there either. But don't lose your foot in one or the other. If you're working with the structural problems, make sure that you're always are connected with actual events that are happening. But if you're working with only treating the events, make sure that you give that knowledge also to the ones that are working with the structures. So thank you, and thanks to you for organizing this. It's been a great evening, and I think you're welcome to email me or approach me afterwards and ask any questions that you may have, because I think it's mingle time now.
Thank you very much, Taha. It was a very interesting speech. Now this part of the evening is coming to an end, and we hope that you all are just as inspired as we are. Right, Daniel?
Yes.
May we please ask all the speakers up on the stage?
You can go a bit forward to the light.
Yes, a bit. Great.
You go. Oh yeah. You can start.
Thank you all so much for being here tonight, for your interesting and inspiring speeches. It has been such a great honor and privilege to have every one of you here tonight. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you all. You can, if you'd like, you can stay. We'll soon be dancing, but first we have some brief information for everybody. The focus group will begin in around 5 to 10 minutes. There is quite a complicated schedule, so listen carefully. The focus groups, lifestyle diseases and sexual and reproductive health will be at the entrance floor. So please go directly to the entrance floor at the cafe. You will find your seats and refreshments. All of the other focus groups, meaning global health diplomacy, global mental health, disaster medicine, global infectious diseases, and global health innovation. Please go up there where you see Darko waving his hands. It's really nice to go up to him, where you'll find your refreshments. All of you others, please participate in the mingle, and we'll see you out there. Thank you and good night.
And please, everyone, will you please bring any trash that you have brought and also these water bottles with you? Otherwise, we have to clean it up. So please.